Welcome to the second Lights, Camera, Action National Summit on the Future of Public Health. Today's summit will focus on data modernization. We appreciate the involvement of our co-hosts, including the Association of State and Territorial Health Officials, or ASTO, the National Association of County and City Health Officials, known as NACHO, and the Big Cities Health Coalition. Appreciation also goes out to our sponsors who made this series possible. Please join me in thanking the United Health Foundation, the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation, and the Pew Charitable Trust for their partnership and financial support. Our first summit focused on the public health workforce and included a robust discussion and extensive participation through chat. Our team summarized the plenary and breakout group discussions, organized the rich content from the chat, and we look forward to sharing that information with all of you soon. The full recording of the first summit is on our Future of Public Health website at futureofpublichealth.org. As we continue this Future of Public Health series into 2022, we look forward to going from summit to action, focusing concretely on how-to actions that rebuild the trust and systems needed to ensure a bright future for public health, and most critically, the public's health. During the first summit, Renee Kennedy from the Michigan Public Health Institute said that it felt like we were having a family meeting. And I say yes, it is in this spirit that we convene today's summit and the future summits. Please express yourself, offer your suggestions, highlight resources, and ask questions throughout the summit through chat. The virtual platform gives us a unique opportunity to have a national conversation. For those of you joining us for the first time, let me review the framing for our Lights, Camera, Action, the Future of Public Health National Summit Series. The lights represent the guiding lights from research, thought leadership pieces, policy recommendations, and exemplars in the field. The camera represents the view of public health through the lens of the pandemic and the loss of trust. Today, there is a need for the United States to refocus the camera to rebuild trust and transform public health in service to communities, people, public health, and the private sector. The camera also emphasizes the need for everything to be seen through an equity lens. Action includes local, state, and national actions informed by the lights and camera. The how-tos discussed here today are a first bite at the apple and will be followed on by post-summit work. Today, we are focusing the lens on creating effective, equitable, modernized public health data systems, a modern data and technology infrastructure that uses actionable intelligence, harnessing the power of today's technology to collect and analyze data in a timely fashion to manage public health threats and conditions is a key action in the new script that we must write for the future of public health. And the data and information needed from multiple sectors, people, and other sources, including public health data, is of most value to understanding and addressing our plot lines when it is collected, managed, and analyzed in a short time frame that allows for insights, recommendations, actions, and policies. As Lewis Carroll, author of Alice in Wonderland, said, if you don't know where you're going, any road will get you there. And Yogi Berra said that if you don't know where you're going, you might wind up someplace else. So we do need to know where we are going and how we are going to get there. Today's technology and analytics support a modern data infrastructure that includes real-time electronic sharing and collection of data for public health action. Data from a wide variety of sources is needed to inform practice and policy. Architecture and design matter. Context matters, equity matters, and most importantly, you and the public matter. We need to be intentional in designing systems that collect data to realize the vision of health equity, and we need data from non-traditional sources. Wastewater surveillance is one example. We have seen the exciting potential of wastewater surveillance grow in scale and utility during the pandemic, and it's a concrete example of the lights that will be highlighted today. In addition to modernizing the data systems, we also need to consider the transformation that will be ongoing to support and sustain these systems. Thus, we will also need a highly skilled workforce with the skills to embrace and apply a modern public health data and surveillance system. Today, we will hear from those writing the new script, and key actors will learn about coming attractions and put the spotlight on those guiding us to the future. So now, it is my pleasure to introduce our keynote speakers. Dr. Daniel Jernigan is the Deputy Director for Public Health Science and Surveillance at CDC, and Dr. Mickey Tripathi is the National Coordinator for Health Information Technology at the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services. They will help set the stage by sharing the vision and defining goals from the federal perspective. Dan, over to you.
Great. I think I'm waiting for the video to come on. All right, great. Thanks. So thanks very much, Judy. And you'd mentioned that it's like a family getting together. I think as I see a lot of the names come through that are attending the meeting today, many of us have worked together for many years. And so I want to say thanks to all of you for all the work that has been going on with COVID, with Omicron here lately. It's been a very long time that people have been responding. next slide, please. So I'm really excited to have the chance to share with you what we're doing at the federal level through CDC's Data Modernization Initiative. It is a national effort supported by CDC with the ultimate goal or North Star to move our nation from siloed and brittle public health data systems to connected, resilient, adaptable, and sustainable response-ready systems that can help us solve problems before they happen and reduce the harm caused by the problems that do happen. DMI is really helping to get better, faster, actionable intelligence for decision-making. For me, and I'm sure for many of you, this work is incredibly personal. With Omicron persisting and the pandemic now entering its third year, we are all exhausted. And it can be challenging to see how changes in data systems can happen. However, I can tell you that they are already changing and some of them are affecting you all as well. Next slide. So I've been at CDC a while and I'm seeing progress now that I've never seen before. Much has changed at some state and local health departments as well. And at the national level, some examples here of some changes that have already occurred. We've seen a massive expansion of electronic case reporting. We used to have 187 healthcare facilities and providers participating before the COVID response, and now more than 10,000 nationwide are participating. This is a capability that will be useful for not only infectious diseases and reportable diseases, but this capability can be used for non-infectious diseases and non-reportable diseases as we move forward with that. We've also had a new cloud-based immunization data lake and gateway. And this is how we've solved the problem of how CDC could take in, analyze, and visualize the incredible volume and velocity of data on vaccine ordering, delivery, and administration. And through this solution, we're now able to expand our vaccine effectiveness data and push data out to the public faster through the COVID tracker on the web. One enormous effort is electronic laboratory reporting. And myself and several of you on this call actually have co-authored papers almost 20 years ago about how we could use electronic laboratory reporting in order to improve public health. And back then the results were mostly on paper and delivered through the mail. And our goal was to pilot the very first systems that would make everything electronic. And so that's why it's very exciting now to see this incredible increase in the amount of electronic laboratory reports, now up to 1.5 million reports per day for COVID PCR tests. In the future, this kind of reporting can be used for all kinds of things, all of the different reportable diseases, but also for others to help us to do the public health work that we need to do. So the changes that are given here demonstrate capabilities that can enable both infectious and non-infectious diseases, as well as changes that impact multiple levels of public health. Next slide. So one of the most important activities in DMI is our commitment to you and to many other end users and your commitment as the community we have around this effort towards shared success. So we've been working with multiple different partners getting information from you, but also reading all the multiple recommendations that have been published from a number of partners that help guide us. In particular, I want to thank those public health partners and point out the Office of the National Coordinator, the Mickey Tripathi, who will be speaking later, who we've developed that relationship with in order to address public health data system changes. Next slide. So we have gone through a process and developed some strategic priorities. Those are available on the CDC DMI webpage now, if you'd like to take a look at them. They're essentially to get the data in an automated way, have a place for it to land, which is a cloud-based platform, take that data and use it in different ways by accelerating it into action, having smart people and bringing on those people and getting our own folks smarter by workforce changes, supporting and extending partnerships to address policy needs, and then changes in managing change and also helping to implement governance across the public health ecosystem. Next slide. So for that first piece, building the right foundation, there are a few critical components that we're working on. One of them is automated real-time data collection. So I mentioned ECR and ELR previously. We're also supporting expansion of syndromic surveillance, vitals through the electronic death registry, notably through the $200 million that were provided to states. But we will be planning to provide additional direct assistance or direct funding to states later this year as well. And also through immunizations that have had a considerable change in the way that they are able to be shared the information from immunization information systems. This area is one that we will be focusing on in FY22, looking at laboratory data exchange, looking at how to have vitals more useful, vital information useful across the board, EHR connectivity, and taking immunization data to see how states and locals can combine that information better and how CDC systems can use those automated data sources in order to fill in that information for the surveillance systems that we have. We are supporting cloud-based services. CDC is actually moving to an entire cloud-based platform, which we have not had for previously, and supporting states to do the same. And in order to understand how best to connect all that together, we're working with partners to help develop a North Star architecture. And I think Mickey will talk a little bit more about that collaborative vision that we're doing to improve state, territorial, local, and tribal access to actionable intelligence. And finally, trying to reduce silos from CDC programs by helping those programs to use that automated electronic data, use the cloud architecture and the shared data and analysis and visualization services, and not have siloed systems that get iterated at states, but rather utilize this architecture for sharing information. Next slide. So the second of the priorities is to accelerate data into action. And so two other priorities we have are listed here, two focuses that we're doing for this FY22. And that first is rapid outbreak response and really helping to develop a common operating picture with tools and platforms that will prepare pandemic-prone programs to scale up in emergencies. We're currently doing that for a lot of the infectious diseases, but also it is the same process that we're the same platform that we're using for wastewater surveillance and the same capabilities that we can use for non-infectious disease outbreaks as well. We're working on forecasting and outbreak analytics, and you'll hear from Dylan George in just a few minutes about the new Center for Forecasting as well, where the platform that we're building will allow for that acceleration of data into action. We're linking and opening data and integrating data, and this is also another area where we'll be focusing for FY22, especially around climate information and how to make that data accessible to other programs at CDC and across the public health ecosystem to state and local partners, and also how we can use integration of data to improve health equity and to identify ways of improving capture of that data that will help with social determinants of health and health equity. And finally, connected public health and healthcare data is really developing new standards. And Mickey will talk a little bit about the shared efforts that we're doing to develop new standards to help bring public health into the healthcare ecosystem so that we can work in that same environment in a much more modernized way. Third slide. The third of the big priorities is developing a state-of-the-art workforce through a $3 billion over 3-year grant program that will be initiated this year. The plans are to improve the capabilities of states and locals and others to have the staff that they need and to get the training that they need in order for there to have the right people in the right place. That will include recruitment, training, forecasting workforce needs, and supporting in order for the states and locals to have the kinds of people that they need. Next slide. In terms of the fourth priority for supporting and extending partnerships, this is really taking that look at that non-technological space. The technology is there. We have the ability to implement all kinds of new things, but we need to also look at the policies to make sure that we can share data appropriately with data use agreements, that we have a trusted environment whereby information can be easily shared among all the different partners. I think Mickey will talk a little bit about TEFCA in that trusted framework and policy and platform. Finally, we are trying to make sure that the information that we have and the processes that we have are transparent so people understand what we're doing and can follow along with us. The next slide. So finally is managing change and governance. At CDC, we have actually changed the way we do our information technology and data governance here. And we realize that if we're going to have an environment where information can be easily shared for emergencies or in peacetime, we need to make sure that the governance of that is there so people understand what's happening to the data and what access they have, et cetera. So that engagement with our state and local partners is going to be critical for defining that governance. At CDC, we will also be monitoring and evaluating a lot of the funds so that we can show what outcomes we have with the funds that we have been putting out, and also to do change management to make sure that we understand the changes that are occurring, people are on board, and they understand where we're, how to be involved in that and know where we're going. Last slide. So what will be different because of the data modernization initiative? So when the next emergency happens, we will have a foundation for data sharing across all levels of public health for coordinated, scalable, and timely case investigation, management, and reporting. We'll have shared analysis capabilities for rapid identification of trends within and across jurisdictions, including forecasting and things like the social determinants of health, and a prepared data science workforce and decreased burden on data reporters and public health staff. So what we've been able to prove during the COVID response is that all of this is possible, that we can see these capabilities in a not too far off future, and importantly, that we know how to get there. So I look forward to working together with you, especially today, to hear from everyone and work with you to work with you in getting all of this done. So thanks very much. And let me hand this over to Mickey.
Okay, great. Thanks, Dan. And thanks, everyone. Thanks to the CDC Foundation and to everyone participating, right, to the public health community. I know, you know, if this is a family gathering, I'm a little bit new to the family. I'm kind of, you know, like that distant cousin who you didn't know was a part of the family, and now I'm a part of it. So it's really a privilege to be working so closely now with the CDC and the public health community at large. What I'm going to cover is a number of things. Let me just walk through what I'm going to cover and then we'll go through it. One is just, you know, first point, CDC and ONC are working very closely together on visioning the public health system of the future. ONC has been advancing interoperability in the healthcare ecosystem at large over a number of years, as many of you may know. But in particular, you know, we've got a number of years here, you know, starting in last year, going over the next few years that are going to be really transformative in interoperability at large across the healthcare delivery system. And we ONC are committed to using all of our available levers to support the CDC and the STILTS in the public health mission. And so what I wanna do is describe a little bit of what's going on in the ecosystem at large. What are those ONC levers I'm talking about? And then specifically how they relate to public health, and then talk about some CDC and ONC joint work in some specific areas that take advantage of these developments specifically to address some public health needs. Last point is, you know, taken together, what we want to be able to do is kind of flip the current ratio of data wrangling to public health action, where I think right now, all of us, and I think you know, anyone in a public health agency, I'm sure would agree that too much time is spent data wrangling, and that leaves too little time to be able to actually turn that into public health action. So all of these levers, everything we're trying to do is to say, how do we flip that equation? so that data and data wrangling and data normalization and the ability and access to have quality data is in the background. And what comes to the foreground is the actionable intelligence, the ability for you to be able to do things with the data that help you to improve public health at large. So next slide, please. So first, just by quick background, ONC was founded in 2004 by an executive order. We're charged with formulating the federal government's health IT strategy and also to work with industry on creating an interoperable nationwide health IT infrastructure. Two very specific authorities I just want to point to very specifically, because we'll come back to these as it relates to what's going on in the industry right now, is first, as many of you may know, in the High Tech Act of 2009, the beginning of the Meaningful Use Program. And that was a program where CMS invested roughly $40 billion to subsidize electronic health records for hospitals and ambulatory providers. And coupled with that was the certification of EHR systems by ONC for those providers who are receiving those incentives. And what that did is it laid a foundation of very functional electronic health record systems across the entire market, so that now we have 90% of hospitals and, well, over 90% of hospitals, over 95% of hospitals and 90% of ambulatory providers using electronic health record systems across the country. That's a dramatic shift from where we were just 10 years ago. So that's an opportunity now for us that foundation's been laid to say, what are we gonna do with that? Now that we have that foundation, how do we help improve public health? What are the various ways that we can tap into that to be able to do the kinds of value-added things that we wanted to be able to do with that foundation? That turns to the 21st Century Cures Act from 2016, which is really focused on how do we use electronic health records to get better healthcare, better population health, and better public health. And there are three things that I point to here, and I'll dive down into these in a second. One is, There's the so-called information blocking provisions, which prohibits providers, technology developers, and health information networks from interfering with the sharing of information with other authorized parties. So it kind of turns what HIPAA frames as permission to share information under certain circumstances to saying, actually, that's an obligation to share that information with other authorized parties. Obviously, within applicable law related to privacy and security and other things, but it kind of changes the dynamic to say that there's an obligation to share information on the behalf of improved quality of care and improved public health. Second thing is that it requires access to information through APIs, application programming interfaces, without special effort. So easy access to information through standardized interfaces that are very, very common across the internet, less common in healthcare. What we're trying to do is say, let's get the healthcare system to be more aligned with the way the rest of the internet works. For those who don't know what an API is, I assure you, you do. When you logged onto Zoom this morning, you are using an API. When you have an app on your phone that allows you to order food or allows you to access your bank account or allows you to access your health record, that's an API behind the scenes that allows you to do that in a very facile, easy, lightweight way. That's what we want to be able to help to enable in the healthcare system. Last thing that comes from the 21st Century Cures Act is what Dan referred to, TEFCA, the Trust Exchange Framework and Common Agreement. And what that directed ONC to do is to create a nationwide governance framework for network-to-network interoperability among clinical data sources. So the idea is, how do we have a backbone architecture that allows organizations to share information at scale to make sure that the medical record information is available where it's needed, when it's needed, and reliably and accurately available for whatever purposes that entity that's receiving the information is authorized to perform. So we'll talk about all of those things in the context of public health now. Next slide, please. So this is a complex slide. So let me just walk through it sort of stepwise here and give you a perspective on where the industry is today and how it's advancing forward. And then specifically, how are some of these ONC levers directly relevant to public health and helping to forward the public health mission? So what I've shown in the middle here, and let's just focus in the middle for a second. You've got the EHR vendors that are in that sandwich layer in the middle. Many of you may be familiar with them. Those are the core clinical source systems. And as I described, 90% of hospitals and ambulatory providers now on electronic health record systems today. So there's now a foundation of electronic data and electronic functionality that we're able to leverage for higher level uses. Going upward from there for a second, we have network interoperability, which is to say, how are these systems connected so that information is shared in the background to make sure that the information when you access or want to be able to access a patient's record, for example, you have access to as much of that information as possible, regardless of where the information was originally sourced from. As we know, patients go to multiple provider settings. And so there are a number of networks that operate today in the market. And TEFCA, what you see there on the top, is the overarching umbrella that provides some governance to connect those networks. And the analogy I would use is, imagine a world where cell phone networks like AT&T and Verizon weren't connected. So great cell phone networks, but if they're not connected, only people within each of those networks could talk to each other. What this does is it says those networks ought to be connected. And how do we have a proper governance framework to allow that to happen? Because as we know, healthcare is more complicated in many ways than telephone exchange. So that's what TEFCA does. We released that for participation just last week. So it was a big announcement, been a lot of work, but that's now available for public participation and for network participation. I'll dive down into that in a second to describe what that might mean for public health. And then working our way downward from that middle sandwich there of EHRs, we've got APIs and other point-to-point kind of interoperability. In the public health community, you're very familiar with HL7V2, which is sort of a core workhorse for access to information and reporting of information via messaging standards from HL7, and that supports immunization reporting, lab results, wide variety of types of transactions. Increasingly, we have FHIR APIs. FHIR, the Fast Health Information Resource, is the more modern convention for interoperability. It's an API type of approach, as I described before, and that allows patient-facing apps, provider-facing apps, and other more easy ways of connecting into systems than have been used by traditional standards, and offers a lot of opportunities for future growth. And I'll talk about that in a second as well. But I just wanted to give you a picture of this landscape. And now let's talk about specifically the ONC levers that are specific to public health and might help to advance public health. So going over to the right-hand side for a second, let's just start from the top to the bottom. The public health access to interoperability networks, one of the things that we are doing with TEFCA is to say that public health is a primary exchange purpose, meaning that public health has to be at the adult table of network interoperability. As many of you may know, and many of you may participate in HIEs at the state or local level, but that's very hard to accomplish. And it's hard to accomplish at scale, in part because some of the rules are very complex, the regulatory issues, and the interoperability conventions are hard to manage. And every state's a little bit different, every HIE is a little bit different. What we want to be able to say with TEFCA is that public health participation has got to be figured out so that public health agencies that want to participate in TEFCA and use that as the for the ability to query records, for example, for particular use cases like a case investigation, for example, to be able to send information via that would be an opportunity to be able to say, I've got one connection that allows me to connect to any other authorized users that participate. And it could even be a vehicle for stilt-to-stilt sharing of information as well. So that's the benefit and the beauty, I think, of public health participation in the interoperability networks. And a lot of work to get done there to figure out the policy pieces of that, but that is now, that is an established exchange purpose, one of the required exchange purposes for TEFCA that we released last week. The second thing I would point to is the information blocking rule, which is a policy requirement. It's not a technical requirement, but as I described before, that prohibits the interference of information, the interference with exchanging information or allowing the sharing of information with other authorized parties. And it supports public health reporting in particular, because not sharing information that's required by law, such as public health reporting, is likely to be considered an interference. And there are penalties associated with being found, in violation of the information blocking provisions. So, I wouldn't put this at the front of everything that we're doing, but I would just suggest that it provides added confirmation, added support to the public health reporting requirements, and can help to support the imperative for everyone to do the public health reporting that's necessary for us to have the public health ecosystem that we need to be able to have going forward. Last thing is the FHIR APIs. We are, one of the requirements from ONC regulations is that this year, by the end of this calendar year, every certified EHR with certified API out in the market is required to have a specific specification for a fire API available for whatever purpose the provider customer wants to use that API for. That'll be a transformative sort of development in the industry, because now every single EHR out there will have this API capability that allows apps to connect to it. The beauty of a fire API is that it's lightweight, modern connectivity. It has an ability to push and pull with the same interface. As you may know, HL7V2 is just push. And then, you know, you don't get the opportunity to be able to query. A fire API allows you to do both. And it gives the ability to build more complex interactions using APIs, like standardized questionnaires that you can just distribute across an entire region, for example, regardless of which EHR system a provider may be using, to have the same questionnaire available in their EHR system, automated aggregation of that information sent back to whoever distributed that, let's say a public health agency, for example. Subscribing to data based on predetermined criteria. So being able to work with an EHR system to say, I want to subscribe to any information that meets these criteria in your system, and then have a certain amount of information pushed to me every time that happens. And then deeply integrated decision support with passively triggered software hooks. All that means is that the ability for me to go through an EHR system, and when I hit a certain part of the EHR system, have it automatically reach out and get decision support from external systems and bring that back in, like public health advisories, like guidance or information that's brought together through the public health infrastructure and then pushed back into the EHR. All of those are the kinds of capabilities that are enabled by FHIR and that we're really excited about. Next slide, please. So those are all the ecosystem developments that I just wanted to make you aware of and point out what ONC is doing in those. We also now want to be able to take advantage of those, which is to say that with working with closely with the CDC and public health agencies in the geographies, the stilts, let's roll up our sleeves and say, how do we take advantage of all of these developments going on in the ecosystem for some really focused, no kidding kinds of projects that have real deliverables and deliver real value. So let me start from left to right. We've got four of them that we're working on very actively. One is Helios. That's the what's called a fire accelerator. And there are a number of these now out in the market. And the idea is for that to be a public-private collaboration working with HL7, the standards organization that owns fire, to say, how do we get a public-private collaboration that takes advantage of the kinds of capabilities that fire offers and accelerates the development of standards and implementation approaches in very specific use cases, in this case related to public health. So Helios is focused on public health use cases, and it's really being able to answer the question, what are the opportunities for using FHIR in public health that can help us sort of be highly innovative and leap ahead into the next generation of interoperability? So Helios is sort of in the process now of just getting launched, just forming the governance, and already starting to consider what are the potential use cases there. And we welcome your participation, your guidance in that. But I think it's a really exciting development, and we've already seen these fire accelerators have added tremendous value to the market, and we're really excited about what Helios will be able to do for the public health community as well. Second thing is USCDI Plus for public health. I won't dive into the details here in the interest of time, but the USCDI is the US core data for interoperability. It is the minimum data set essentially that's required by ONC to be in certified EHR systems across the country. And so for the healthcare delivery side of our healthcare system, the USCDI is in some ways the minimum data set of the healthcare delivery system. Every certified EHR system is required to support the ability to send and receive the USCDI data elements. We're working with the CDC in particular on what we think of as the USCDI Plus for public health, which is to say, all right, those are core elements. What do we need for a true public health data model? And how do we standardize more elements that would be included in the public health data model, building on what we know is available in EHR systems today? So that's also really exciting work. We've got a lot of really heavy engagement with the, with ONC, the CDC, and a number of STILT partners as well. And we're really excited about where that's headed and the opportunities that gives us to leverage what's already available in EHR systems to get us, better public health data and more uniform public health data. TEPCA, I've talked about that, so I won't dive more into those details, but the work now ahead with that is for us to work in an engaged manner with the public health community, CDC and STILTS, to be able to say, how do we iron out some of the wrinkles related specifically to public health? As we know, there are a number of, you know, of specific issues related to public health. Some of them are HIPAA issues, minimum necessary types of issues, data requirement sorts of issues related to the different public health use cases. And what we want to be able to do is say, how do we iron those out in a collaborative type of process so that we can then say, here is what it means for a public health agency to participate in TEPCA. And to have the assurance that when they query for information, they'll get something back, and hopefully the opportunity for providers to be able to query a public health system and get some information back as well. Those are all things that we can now roll up our sleeves on and work on, and set some real, you know, sort of milestones for when that's available. As I said, it's a required exchange purpose for TEPCA. So the only work that's now needed for us to go ahead is to develop what are those standard operating procedures to make it real so that a public health agency can say, all right, now I know what that means. Now I'm willing to join. Last thing, and I'll talk about this a little bit more in the next slide, is the North Star architecture that Dan had referred to. And it's really about assisting the CDC and the public health community with an infrastructure to ease the burden and increase the effectiveness of public health data systems and applications. So why don't we turn now to the next slide, and I'll describe that. So this is, you know, sort of a broad picture of the idea of having a North Star cloud-based service model. And the first thing I would just say is, you know, I think there's a Dilbert cartoon that says, you know, something like, isn't the cloud just someone else's data center? And the answer to that, I would say, is no. it's an affirmative no. Because in this case, what we're talking about is a cloud-based service model where it's not just a data center. It is an open architecture platform based on open industry standards to allow the sharing of data, the sharing of tools, the sharing of applications, importantly, with a transparent set of policies and rules that allow partners and participants, like a STILT, for example, to have control over their own data and the control of their use of their data, but transparent mechanisms for how that information is shared and how that information is used, but takes advantage of what cloud infrastructure offers to be able to get the benefits of scale and the benefits of sharing, sharing tools, sharing applications, sharing data. So just to cover this very quickly, you have on the left-hand side, and I'm just gonna go through these in turn, overarching is a collaborative governance model, joint CDC and STILT governance model that it's, you know, still being worked on, but the idea is that we need to have shared governance over this platform for the opportunity to be able to have the appropriate sharing with the, you know, the need for participation of those who are going to be using it, to have the assurance that they know what's happening with their data, they know what what's going on with the platform itself. On the left-hand side, you've got, you know, three types of capabilities that this cloud infrastructure enables. One is a hosted STILT infrastructure. And what that means is that there may be certain state, local, tribal, territorial public health agencies who would prefer to actually not manage their infrastructure anymore. Maybe it's, you know, maybe it's high cost. Maybe it's too cumbersome. And the opportunity to be able to say, you know what, I'd rather just have that be a part of this cloud. And that may be lower cost, it may be afford the opportunity to have, you know, greater efficiencies. So for those folks that would like to do that, the idea is offer a hosted environment that's segmented so that STILTs aren't all thrown in the same pot. Each one has their own segmented environment that they locally control, but they have the benefit of scale, lower cost infrastructure that they themselves don't have to manage, APIs and interfaces built in, so you don't have to work on how do I, you know, get all those interfaces coming into my infrastructure, and then the opportunity to get shared tools and applications, for example, if you want to use them. Again, the requirement isn't to use them. And the idea is also to have consolidated and standardized data ingestion and APIs. So we don't need to have 64 different interfaces to Epic or to Cerner or to eClinicalWorks. Maybe you can consolidate that into a single interface that comes in, consolidates, you know, multiple geographies into a single interface, and then distributes it appropriately to the right, to the right STILT tier, but creates a lot of efficiency and takes that burden off of the STILTs, importantly, for establishing and maintaining them. Second thing in the middle here is the idea of having shared tools and tooling and applications. So it's a platform for access to software as a service tools and applications that are either a STILT managed one that a particular STILT might want to share with another jurisdiction, for example, or something that the CDC has provided, or it's something that a third party, a private developer as provided and under a set of rules is able to make available for people to be able to use. The idea here is creating that platform for the opportunity to share building blocks. And that could be for a tool or for an application. So a full-blown application, you know, might be an actual public health application to be able to, you know, do case reporting, for example, or to be able to do, anything related to, syndromic surveillance or whatever it is that's a public health application, or the underlying tools. A tool to be able to do PPRL, patient preserving, record linkage, for example, or data normalization, for example, but being able to do that more efficiently and more consistently and not having to have everyone develop their own way of doing it. It includes, and then the idea also is that there would be APIs, open APIs that allow access for hosted and non-hosted stilts. So to the point that I made before, some stilts may choose, you know what, I want to keep my own infrastructure. I want to manage it myself. I don't want to be a part of a hosted infrastructure. That's totally fine. But the opportunity for them to be able to still have API access to the shared tooling and applications is something that's really important. We don't want them to not participate in the benefits of this. And then finally, all the way on the right, and I'm going to move really quickly here, is the shared data repositories. The idea of having very specific aggregations of data and sharing of data, de-identified data, identified data in certain circumstances that are available for authorized parties to be able to access, where the idea is that you have transparent governance that determines whose data is being shared, how is it being aggregated, and who's able to access it and for what purpose. And the benefit of the cloud environment is that that becomes transparent with a set of policies and the governance that determines that and becomes much more efficient to do it in that same architecture. So the idea here is we want to be able to provide the benefits of common infrastructure and preserving SOAP control and data use. So last slide. And so bottom line is we are working very closely with the CDC on this collaboration. We've got many opportunities to leverage advances in health IT, and we welcome the opportunity to use cloud-based open architecture infrastructures to reduce the burden on all of you and to increase the ability for us to do the things that we need for public health going forward. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you, Mickey, and to Dan. And now we're going to move quickly to a poll question for all of you to get audience input. So the recent multi-billion dollar investment, modernized public health data systems, offers unprecedented opportunities to generate real-time, complete, and actionable data to prevent disease, promote wellness, and assure prosperity. What concrete actions would you prioritize during the next 1 to 3 years to help assure those investments translate into long-lasting improvements to the health data system? Choose one option, and here are your options, and we'll give you a minute to select. And again, keep your ideas and questions going in the chat, and feedback is terrific coming through the chat. And you can mentally be doing the Jeopardy music in your head while you're answering. We should have results here momentarily. And there you are. Number one is linking diverse data sets across public health and healthcare and non-health sectors takes the lead there. So I'm going to move us along quickly now. And we're going to next welcome Dr. Dylan George, who's Director of Operations for the Center for Epidemic Forecasting and Outbreak Analytics at CDC. Dylan will share a coming attraction spotlight on the new center. So Dylan, take it away.
Yeah, hi everybody. It's a pleasure to be with you all today, and super excited to talk to you very briefly about what we're building at the CDC is what's referred to as the Center for Forecasting Outbreak Analytics going forward. Next slide. There, yep. So the main objective, what I hope you take from this more than anything else, is the main objective of the Center for Forecasting and Outbreak Analytics is to provide better data, better analytics for a better response in an outbreak scenario. It's like, I don't need to convince this group on this call that disease outbreaks are becoming more frequent and more disruptive, especially even prior to COVID, that was true, but it's a very fine point on it with what's happening with the COVID pandemic. And the data systems, as we all know, need to be improved so that we can be much more responsive and effective going forward. And so the CDC has identified this as a priority. As you've already seen from the efforts that Dan and Mickey have described in terms of the data modernization efforts, and the Center for Forecasting Outbreak Analytics is going to figure out how to use improved advanced analytics and predictive analytics to actually provide the evidence base that will be needed to support decision support at the federal, state, and local levels going forward in an outbreak crisis. And the capacity that we're trying to build is not only for those that happen to be near universities or have a major national laboratory in their backyard, but it's a capacity and capability that we're trying to build for all Americans across the board. And so that's what we're looking for. And so that's the particular effort that we're trying to drive going forward in the center. Next slide, please. So the center is gonna focus on three big functions. We refer to these big functions as predict, inform, and innovate. We are going to build a world-class data science team that will be able to generate forecasts, analyses to support preparedness and outbreak response efforts. Again, at the federal, state, and local levels is where we're trying to target our efforts. This team will also develop a data and analytical technology architecture that will interface with the legacy systems that Dan has mentioned and that Mickey is helping to build going forward, so that will be available to those that would like to be participate and take advantage of those capacities. And so predict is a function of providing better analytics to guide public health interventions in a timely and actionable way. So that's predict. Inform is an explicit recognition that risk communications is very challenging, especially in a time of crisis under lots of uncertainty with what's going on. And so we wanted to take time to explicitly recognize that trying to help people understand the uncertainty of an unfolding event in the fog of war, the complexity of the analytics that we're going to try to bring to bear to that situation, and the myriad of options that are available for any particular decision maker to think about in using in a public health intervention, integrating across all of those and communicating that information in a timely and useful way is really very challenging. And so we are going to develop a team that will help enable that push forward analytic or technology that will help us interface with a larger, broader audience and establish that information in a timely and actionable way going forward. So that's predict, that's inform, and innovate is the third function of what we're going to be working on. Is we need to get much better across the board on collecting, aggregating, cleaning, analyzing, presenting evidence base, using it in decision support tools, visualizing data. We need to get better across the board on that and in using it for the decision support functions. So we're going to be spending money and efforts in how do we actually improve those capabilities across the board for forecasting and analysis. So predict, inform, and innovate. And then of course, there's gonna be a technology component that will enable all of those functions across the board. Next slide. Dan and Mickey have already done a beautiful job talking about some of the advances of the data modernization effort. The data modernization will be critical to the success of the Center for Forecasting and Outbreak Analytics. And we will be the beneficiary of using those data more effectively to help guide public health interventions effectively going forward. And so as you think of this, the pipeline of going from collection, aggregation, cleaning, processing, CFA will be on the tail end where we'll be doing more analytics, more decision support to provide that evidence base to help decisions know which interventions to be actually put into place so you can maximize the public health benefit while minimizing the social disruption and economic disruption of those particular interventions. Next slide, please. this is the last slide I'll share with you right now. That and what you're seeing right here is an example of an analogy to weather forecasting. Now, what this figure is showing you is on the x-axis, you have time across decades. On the y-axis, you have a measure of forecasting skill of how to do numerical forecasting more effectively and how well the models and data were doing in actually forecasting the skill. You don't really need to know the specific details of how they derived that, but what it's showing is over these decades, the United States and the world were pretty rubbish at how we were actually forecasting weather back in the 50s and 60s. Advanced to today, there was a progression of our ability and capability to actually do this weather forecasting to the point where today we're pretty good at it. And everybody has, you know, their own mobile device of choice where they can actually see what the forecast will be over the next handful of days. And they intuitively know how to use that information to modify their behavior based on what that's telling them. And so we know how to incorporate that into our own personal and collective decision-making because it's gotten to a state where we, so if we know that in the next 2 days, it says it's in the next day, it's gonna be an 80% chance of rain, we'll probably grab an umbrella. If it says in 2 weeks, it's gonna be an 80% chance of rain, if it's a special event that day, we'll probably keep an eye on it, but we probably won't change plans until we get a little bit closer. So we intuitively know how to use that information to guide our decision-making. Now, what has allowed that advance and that monotonic increase in capabilities over the time? Well, it's been data, it's been models, it's been people, it's been computational power, it's been using them in specific ways, and then also sustained effort and funding through time. Similarly, for disease forecasting and analytics, we are kind of in the 50s and 60s kind of era. There is exceptional promise in using improving outbreak analytics and forecasting to guide public health interventions. We've seen it already within the COVID and particularly within the Omicron variant kind of era of how this can be helpful. And there's even more promise that can be leveraged going forward, but we need to become much better at how we're using that, much better at how we're providing that to the state and locals, and much better at how we can actually improve upon that capability going forward. So we're super hopeful, we're super excited, and we want to learn from this group on how we can benefit, particularly the state and locals, on how to help them engage and take advantage of the capability that we're building. And so we would love to get feedback from you all on that, and would love to have interactions with you on thinking about how to maximize the benefit of this capability for everyone. So with that, I will stop and thank you very much for the opportunity to chat with you today. Appreciate it.
Thank you, Dylan. Really exciting work. So we're going to move now to our first panel for the day. Our first panel will focus on shifting the system, data as a common good for public health. Remember, you can participate in the discussion by posting comments in the chat, and our team will be posting live during the session as well. If you want to use any social media on your own channels, use hashtag LCA Summit. So leading this first panel is Les Becker, Deputy Secretary of Innovation and Technology at the Washington State Department of Health. Les, thank you so much for joining us, and I'm going to turn the panel to you.
Thank you, Judy. I'm excited to moderate such a timely discussion today, and I have three great panelists I'd like to introduce. I'd first start with Dr. Gail Christopher from the National Collaborative on Health Equity. Thank you, Gail. Second, we have Anish Chopra from Care Journey. Thank you, Anish. And finally, we have Dr. Ethan Burke from United Healthcare Group. Thank you all for your participation today. The panel objective is to really define catalysts and support the needs of our heroes to champion better, faster data that improves both health, wellness, and the prosperity for everyone, everywhere. And as we start looking at some questions I'd like to put in front of you, I'd like all three of you to chime in. If we could start with Ethan, go to Anish, and then Gail to finish this one out. We've heard from the opening speakers the need for and the promise of better, faster data for public health decision-making. And the focus of this panel is on common good. Common is defined as belonging equally to or shared alike by all in question. So I'd like to start by asking you, what do you see as the support public health needs to ensure that data is truly a common good?
Yeah, thank you. That's a great question to start. And I was thinking a lot about this one this morning, that to me, data is a means to some end. And I think our challenge in the world of public health has been that assuming just more data is better will solve the problem. And I think for this common good and all of us feeling that we're equally contributing to and benefiting from the data means that we have to build around that. Why do we need the data in the first place? And importantly, how do we communicate to the public, as well as policymakers who fund us, that getting these data are important to turn it into insight, to turn it into actionable information. So communicating that why is important, and that's how we start to build trust. And when the public and policymakers trust us with their data and see the benefit from those data streams that we've worked so hard to integrate and harmonize and gain new understanding from in a rapid way, then we start to build a sustainability model where in the public seeing the benefit of this approach and this infrastructure, we start to have sustainable funding streams that let us do more and expand and be more responsive than we were in the past. So the data and the hooking the pipes together is incredibly important, but if we don't surround that with a story and robust communication about why we need to do this in the first place and how people feel the benefit of it, I feel that it's short-lived until a pandemic or a crisis is over and we're right back again where we started. So for a sustainable data approach, we have to make sure everybody is on board.
All right, thank you, Ethan. Anish?
And I echo much of what Ethan shared. I think you're gonna hear a lot of alignment in the panel. Just three pieces of context. One, my bias going in is when I was President Obama's chief technology officer, my assignment was to open up as much data to make it available for the public. The idea of common good is to take data that might have been hiding or, you know, kind of burying certain truths about our healthcare system and unearthing it so that we can make it more accessible for the American people, which means applications that are meant for public health purposes, as they release the data that's held by our largely privately administered healthcare system, is itself a vehicle for delivering on this vision of a common good, i.e. the more public health has legal authority to tap data sets and to release them to the American people, that virtuous cycle will give us a little bit more open and turn what is essentially an opaque system into a more transparent one. So that was a mixture of point one and two, meaning we have the history of the need for open data. It's got to be done through applications. And that's my third point, which is, to me, the more we build on the regulated and standardized data systems, the easier it is going to be for us to lower administrative burdens to deliver this information to the public good. So there's a lot of dialogue in the chat. I love this back and forth with Jacqueline Cutts, whom I don't know, and all these people commenting. This is all about how local and state health officials, with the authority to set priorities in their neighborhoods, to be able to tap the regulated data sources in order to inform their neighbors. And then we can stitch together the mosaic going forward. So this is about you raising your hand and saying, put me in, coach. This is the year to join.
Great. Thank you, Nish. Gail?
Thank you. I agree with my colleagues, and it's so impressive to see what work the CDC is already doing. I think the voice that may be missing, and I'm going to frame that voice as a support that public health needs, is the voice of diverse populations locally in communities, the voice of the common people, of the, you know, what is the common good? Who are the we in this conversation? And so I think finding very specific ways to engage and listen to those voices. I was privileged to chair a recent commission created by the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation on charting a course for an equity-centered transformation of our public health data system. And if you're going to bring equity into the center, not an afterthought, not an also, but at the center, then you're going to have to listen to the voices of the people whose voices are usually not expressed. And I think that's a critical support. The other is to recognize, as my colleagues have said, in a way, you know, public health data is a new narrative. It tells a story. And if this story that's being told is only based on existing algorithms, which reinforce the elephant in the room, which is racism, structural and historic racism, then we're not going to really achieve equity and we're not going to move toward well-being. in a positive sense. And so I think the supports are recognizing the primacy of seeing data not only as information and as a system of surveillance and prediction, but also as a narrative that is telling a very real story and making sure that that story embodies our hopes and our aspirations for greater opportunity for all.
Thank you, Grell. Thank you, all panelists. That was fantastic input. And kind of keeping with that same theme, Gail, if you wouldn't mind starting us out on this next question, what are some of the actions, given your previous answer, that we would need to take to build that trust and understanding so that the people and the patients and the community really see the benefits of sharing that data?
You know, we were privileged to bring together some of the leading diverse voices on this recent commission, and they were very clear that there is not appropriate data disaggregation, you know, that reflects the complexity of multiple populations and perspectives. So one of the actions that I think the marvelous technology platforms that we have, you know, one of the actions is to focus on real-time data that is a reflection of local communities down to the zip code, you know, and the congressional districts, and to make sure that that data is disaggregated in ways that reflect the consistent barriers to opportunity. You know, we talk about social determinants, and that's become a good mantra, a good buzzword, but we fail to really acknowledge how much social determinants in this society are driven by our legacy of a belief in racial hierarchy. So we have to tie the opportunity that COVID has laid bare, the opportunity to do the racial reckoning, with the opportunity to drive toward equity in ways that reflect and honestly capture the history of how racial hierarchy has been institutionalized in all of our systems, particularly at community levels.
Thank you. Ethan, Anish, would you like to chime in on this?
I would agree with that. I would say there's two pieces just to build on what was just said, that data needs to be a two-way street here. And we in public health might always think that we know what the elements are that are important. But I think to Gail's point, we need to ask the question and be good listeners to know what data to collect. We can't get everything. It's just not going to happen. And our systems will be overwhelmed. So we need to be smart on collecting elements that are actually useful for the question we're trying to solve, and make sure we have our listening hats on to understand what's important to the communities that we're trying to be working with. The second piece that comes to mind is that not all data for public health is health data. And getting out of our silo of health and thinking about other sectors, which are all kind of artificial in how they're based. We have a Department of Education, a Department of Transportation, a Department of Health, but all of those are people. And how do we start to think about important data elements, particularly around social determinants and real-time actionable data, and all of those words that might be coming from industries and sectors other than our own? But that contextual information is so important to us understanding how then to turn that into something that's actionable. If we're trying to make public health interventions in schools, for instance, which has been a big controversy in COVID, and we've done a lot of work on that, how do we not do that without understanding the schools through what data they collect? Or do we need to help them collect data better so we can have a meaningful impact on that population, similarly with transportation or other industries? So those are just a few ideas I would add on, that we need to think broadly about what does data mean and what elements matter most for the question we're trying to solve, and how do those stakeholders help us collect those no matter what industry or sector they happen to sit in.
Great, thank you, Ethan.
Maybe I could just take a little bit of a real world example of this challenge. And Gail, you really have set the moral high ground for where we should go, and I appreciate your leadership in commenting. When the lab results were coming in on COVID positive patients to Chicago's health department, Rush University Medical Center, kind of the modern EHR platform, basically volunteered to help connect the following dots. The minority of those reports had race and ethnicity information assigned or attached to the file. Rather than change the whole IT system of the world, they simply said, hey, let me look through the EHR networks in the neighborhood to see if the EHR systems have race and ethnicity captured and just marry the two data systems, and the race and ethnicity completion factor went up without a lot of undue burden other than just connecting these two networks. However, and this is a practical point, who's actually entering race and ethnicity? Is it the staff person who's looking at you and saying, I think you look Indian, so I'm going to put you down as such? Or is it a person who's self-entering this as part of a registration process? One of the gaps in our data system today is that patient-generated data is not regulated and standardized for sharing. So one of the reasons why I'm eager to join this call is this is the year. If enough state and local agencies say we want to collect race, ethnicity, social needs, and other factors, you have the power to develop a FHIR questionnaire. This is one of the interoperability standards that Mickey had spoken of a few minutes ago. And you can connect it without special effort to your local hospitals that are on the Cures Act regulated EHRs no later than December. You have that power. You list the questions, you connect it to the local systems and ensure that individuals can complete this information and it is shared consistently across. No one else is going to do it for you. You can do it. Thankfully, surveying is cheap. This is not a multi-billion dollar 20-year IT project, okay? But it requires leadership. Some state and local leaders have to say, I want to collect this array to reflect the true problems in our community. And I would turn to Gail to be the definer of this initial set, and let's get moving. Once the industry gets familiar with how to do this work, then it can go through a regulatory process to scale everywhere. But right now, standardized questions for consumers to fill out, not regulated, but could be if we get early adopters.
Thank you, Nils. I think that's a great point about the FHIR aspect. And, you know, as we look at the investment, it's been tremendous as to what's happened in public health out of the pandemic, and it's underway right now. I'd really like you to focus in on what we can do in the near term to build on the real world examples that you talked about. FHIR, we have the electronic case reporting mandates. There's broad COVID plus lab reporting that we heard about earlier. There's projects like Helios and Prime. So Nish, could you talk a little bit about what we need to do in the short term, the 12 to 24 months, to really be a catalyst for moving this forward?
Team A, Team B. So for many of you that have been working with HIE, network access, you're going to keep plowing through interfaces. God bless you. That's a heavy work, a lot of burden. Go for it. But if any of you want to leapfrog into the internet economy, the way Mickey described our use of our phones and so forth, in this calendar year, Team B can meet every one of those mission accomplishments through an internet application. In my view, a coalition of Team B can actually, with very small investment, make a significant impact. We've talked about collecting social needs for case reporting, for meeting the obligations of the kind of ongoing COVID data collection on bed capacity reporting, on ELR with demographics. Take every requirement that we just enumerated, Lee, and the opportunity, or less, is to say, we can make this, Team B can be discharged today to use simple, lightweight internet applications. They may be consumer-facing, they may be physician-facing, they may be case manager, epi-facing. These apps can be run, and no later than December of this year, the doctors and hospitals in your neighborhood will have a version of an EHR capable of connecting those apps. So please field Team B. Not everybody on this call can, but if you can and wish, there's an army of folks that want to help you move that forward.
I want to add one thing onto that if I can. So maybe, I don't know, Nish, if this is like a Team C or a Team B.5, or I don't know, but I can tell you, I definitely don't want to be on Team A because that's a tough place to be. I think in thinking about COVID testing, as an example, and you were asking about, you know, real world and what's the world we're in right now. I think we all need to be skating towards the world where the testing is not going to be happening in our big institutions and certainly not going to be happening in public health labs at the frequency that it is now. Home testing is here to stay. And COVID has made that possible and demonstrated the benefit. And there's a lot of tests under EUA and other mechanisms. But I have no doubt that we will see more home testing for other conditions that are important to public health data collection around sexually transmitted infections, other respiratory diseases. You know, there's been home testing for a long time. We're seeing that market increase dramatically. And as it does, our data visibility is going to start to decrease because now tests are being done in living rooms and not tied into any large system. But the reason I was tying it back to your B.5 is there, we need to start thinking about ways to capture data that are not done in our legacy institutions. That lab is now becoming a distributed model, and where data are initially realized at that root level is happening in kitchens and bedrooms, more so than doctors' offices and laboratories in academic medical centers. So how do we leverage a lot of the technologies and interfaces that Anish and others have been talking about and capture data from home and self-testing environments to inform public health that like we are expecting and has happened in the past, but is going to start to get harder and harder. We're already seeing that with COVID cases now, that we have a significant portion that we're missing. That's going to happen for other illnesses important to public health too. I think there's an opportunity with a lot of the data structure work that we've been talking about to try to recapture that and make sure that that's included, particularly for populations that don't have access to these larger systems and are going to a local drugstore, buying a test and doing it on their own. How do we hear their voice?
If I could just add, you know, we have to have a certain amount of humility, recognizing that we have not done this well in terms of the equity and the racial piece. And again, it drives back to the importance of listening and engaging communities whose voices traditionally have not been involved. So I believe in the A and the B, and I think there's a C as we widen our aperture in terms of understanding that well-being and health is such a broad concept, and we need to make sure that we are looking at the indicators, and this has been said, but I want to reiterate it, looking at the indicators that increase the risk for stress and chronic disease, which increases the vulnerability to infectious disease. And that requires that we take, you know, a social determinants, equity perspective, and again, we listen to the voices that the pandemic showed us simply have not been heard.
Go ahead, Anish.
I assume this is our last question given the time slots, but I just wanted to comment on Gail's point here. My advice is hug a local ACO. In my opinion, your ally in this very important with humility engagement is a risk-bearing physician network, is the most appropriate ally to public health to put together the kind of data capture, action, engagement, opportunity. And if we saw throughout the pandemic, ACOs had more of their beneficiaries engage in telemedicine than the traditional fee-for-service system, which kind of left people on their own to figure this thing out. So my view is close that loop, find your risk-bearing physician networks. Medicare has already said they want 100% of Medicare and Medicaid beneficiaries in these models by 2030. A natural question is, can state and local health departments align with them to solve these immediate, this is not a data tech issue, oh, we need an app for that. This is going to be engaging in a very coherent, systematic way that takes advantage of the low friction, low cost internet applications environment in these trusted circles that almost by definition have to be neighborhood by neighborhood.
Yep.
I think it's a good, I mean, that gets to this importance of public and private partnerships, which I know is a theme throughout, but also public health working with acute care medicine together and the schism that we all talk about. This is an opportunity that Anish is talking about to really heal that and leverage the strengths that each side of that brings. There's I think we're all trying to work towards the same end. And I think this is a great opportunity to do that around these data elements and working with our partners in primary care and specialty care, as well as public health.
Yeah, thank you. I think we have time for at least one more. So I'd like to switch over and talk a little bit about where you were talking about Team A, Team B, Team C, all this work that needs to happen with ACOs. That's a lot of investment, and there's a lot of effort that has to go into do all this and coordinate it. So how do you make this sustainable for the long term? And I think Anish is disagreeing with my framing, so I'd like to go to him first.
Nouns and verbs, okay? If you have to buy IT, this thing is a never-ending money pit that's going to drain everybody forever. Verbs are to build upon the regulated pipes so that your incremental investment is just the governance and management as the pipes work in your favor. So what we need to do is have enough early adopters to get that initial pipe that's regulated route through the public health system as designed, state and local, bottom up, not top down. And again, I turn to the CDC Foundation. My guess is there's an incredible amount of capital coming through the funding from Congress and all of the activities. There's so much goodwill and investment. It's mostly what's needed is people wanting to raise their hands and say, can you prototype the open source team B option with me? I don't think anyone's going to be needing to write huge checks to do things because you're not buying a massive monolithic IT system. You just need to connect to the pipe safely and securely. And that is a lot. It's more of a mental challenge than it is a technical big investment challenge.
That's a great way of framing that. Ethan, Gail, any comments on that?
You know, my perspective is driven by years in philanthropy. And I know that foundations can be real catalysts for the types of innovation. And I agree that we're not talking billions here, but making sure that local communities have the resources to do the innovative work that has never been done before, to create the partnerships and the alliances and the cross-sector collaborations. As a part of our recent effort at the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation, the foundation has put out $50 million to support innovative efforts with historically Black colleges and universities around this data transformation to make certain that the communities that are most vulnerable in the Gulf region, for instance, to the problems created by environmental injustice is another illustration, to see where state and local policies are being redesigned to support more innovative approaches to data. So I would say, yes, we need the federal investment and we need cross-sector collaboration, but we also need those innovative investments at the state and local level with communities to help build up that trust and that capacity and those relationships to do what quite honestly has never been done before and seize this moment.
I would say the key to sustainability is people understanding the value and the benefit beyond when the crisis period is over. Or beyond that 48 hours after the announcement. And that comes down to people understanding what they get for what they give and how do we communicate the value better. Communication's cheap, but don't underestimate its power in driving policy change that's long lasting versus one-offs. And I think we struggle when money appears and then money disappears and money appears and money disappears. Sustainability is about making sure people understand long-term value. And I would say communication is a place where we have a huge opportunity for people to understand the importance of data.
Great, those are fantastic answers. And I think you've spurred a lot of thought with the people on the call. We do have time for one final question, and it's a simple question in theory, but I'd like you to take about a minute to a minute and a half each to kind of answer this in your perspective. And we'll start with you, Gail. How do you just avoid boiling the ocean with the complexity that we've talked about here today and the workforce challenges that we've all talked about on the last call?
You know, I just don't like that metaphor because it suggests how do you do the impossible? And if we are believing in possibility here, in necessity, I would even say in the imperative for doing this well, then I don't think we want to use that particular metaphor or analogy. We avoid floundering, you know, we avoid failing by working together and being honest about the scope and the scale of the challenge.
Great, thank you, Gail. Ethan?
So I wrote down, you can't see my blurred board behind me, but I have bird by bird written up there right now. If you haven't read the book, I encourage it. But I think we need to be intentional in what we're trying to do with the data. And then there's an important concept in innovation called de-risking. And as we go through a complex solution, how do you take it piece by piece or bird by bird and de-risk as we go so it stays long-lasting and sustainable? And it comes back to what I was just mentioning on the last question about that communication, but really understanding why we're doing what we're doing and then take it apart piece by piece so you're not boiling the ocean, because these are achievable and important things, but you have to do it in an intentional, thoughtful way and de-risk as you go so things don't fall apart.
Great, thank you. And Ethan, Nisha, we'll close out with your own your comments. Thank you.
Just very quickly, I think the point here is the doctors and hospitals in your neighborhood now have a new plug in the wall that you can basically plug into in order to access the information you need. At a minimum, have a little outlet that you could plug into. That's it. The question here is, if this new capacity is online and you're not using it, there's no boiling the ocean because it's not helping anyone. Use the pipes that are available, meaning that socket in the wall. And that's that Cures Act API that Mickey described earlier today. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, panelists.
Thank you. Well, thank you all very much. That was an amazing panel. And we're going to move right into our second panel now. And this panel is real-time data for public health action. What is actionable intelligence? Leading the second panel is Dr. Annie Fine, who's the Chief Science and Surveillance Officer, Senior Advisor to Data Modernization Initiative at the Council of State and Territorial Epidemiologists, or CSTE. So Annie, over to you.
Can you see my video?
Yes.
Okay, great. Thank you so much, Judy and the CDC Foundation. And I'm delighted to be here. What an amazing panel we just heard. I hope that we can build upon all of those thoughts. And I'm delighted to have with me Jim Daniel from Amazon Web Services, Abigail Echo Hawk from the Urban Indian Health Institute, and Dylan George, who we heard from before, from the CDC. So our objective with this panel is to describe the necessary connection between complete, consistent, both historic and real-time data, the context, political, economic, social, and technological, and knowledge needed to maximize improvements to the public's health, all in a short 30 minutes. Not a tough objective. Okay, so I am going to encourage our panelists to A, think beyond COVID, address the need, as we kind of touched upon in the previous panel, to really, for public health, as opposed to health care, to integrate information and not just raw data, but information for action at the person level, community and neighborhood level, and then for specific groups, populations that might be more vulnerable to certain kinds of health threats, as well as at the state, tribal, territorial, and federal levels. Action takes place at all of these levels. And we need information, not just data, to act at all those levels too. So importantly, as a previous panel, Ethan mentioned, was knowing what questions we want to answer. Asking the questions is probably the most important part in terms of determining how to make data actionable, make intelligence out of data. And I just wanted to mention that takes people, takes resources. I know state and local health departments are struggling with this every day. An example is just integrating data at the person level. Many people across the United States are spending staggering numbers of hours just trying to reconcile reports about different people from different sources. And that comes from healthcare, from labs, from all over the place. So anyway, we are going to talk about that now. And I would also invite the folks in the audience to contribute to the chat with concrete high priority steps that you think we can take to make data more actionable in real time and in longer time for other conditions besides infectious diseases or COVID. We should think well beyond that. Okay, so our first question is complete, consistent, historical, and real time. Are data characteristics important in driving action for equity? What other characteristics are equally or perhaps more important even when considering how data links to public health action? And I'm going to turn first to Jim and then ask the other panelists to comment also.
Thanks, Annie. So I think when I think about the real-time data coming in, there's just so much of it now. And we are just overwhelmed with data. And that's raw data coming in, and raw data is not actionable. And in order for our public health systems to make sense of it, in order for epidemiologists to actually use it, there are a lot of processes that data has to go through in order to actually be usable. And I think, you know, one of the things that we learned during COVID, I know you said not to focus just on COVID, but a really important lesson is our systems that process that data have to scale. We saw so many examples across the country where the systems that were just taking in basic information like ELR were taking in, you know, in 2 days more than they had taken in an entire year before. And those systems just weren't set to scale. So I think it's really important to think about, you know, how newer technologies like cloud services can really help us scale those types of systems for processing the data when we need to scale it, but also scale back down when we don't need it. And I think that's another really important aspect of this is the sustainability. We can't afford to pay for these things to be on all the time, and we need to be able to scale them back down when they're not in use and not pay for them. So I think that scalability is a really important piece as well. And I know, you know, the question is really around real-time data. And sometimes real-time data can be more expensive to access than data that's not real-time. And I think, you know, I'm going to go off question a little bit because I think we also need to think about the data that's actionable for equity that is not always necessary to be real-time. And if we're talking about sustainability and when we're thinking about chronic disease and other types of conditions that a public health department might follow, it's not always critical that that's real time. And we need to think about when we actually need it and when we're going to make it actionable so that we can build the systems to support that and only pay for what we need. And another, I think, really important part of the equation here as we think about modern technologies to support bringing in all of this real time data are things like machine learning that can help make sense of all the data. If we're looking at data from electronic health records and we're looking at free, you know, even some of that structured data is hard to interpret. And we need that machine learning in order to really figure out what it all means and to help put it together.
Thank you so much, Jim. Abigail or Dylan, would you like to add anything on this topic before we move on?
Yeah, I think it's really important to acknowledge that we have all of this now and folks are reaching towards this real-time data. But unless we recognize that the real-time data that is currently available is based on a system of embedded structural, individual, and institutionalized racism that has effectively harmed communities of color and other communities, we're working within a data system that continues to cause harm. So we could have all the real-time data, all of the machine learning, everything that we ever wished for, but if we don't address, like Dr. Christopher said, the embedded systems of racism, it won't matter. The community outcomes in my community, American Indian, Alaska Natives, will continue. I see this embedded racism consistently, where I see states and the federal government not recognizing tribal public health authority. Tribes and some urban Indian organizations hold tribal public health authority, which means they should be treated in the same way as a state public health department. And yet we fight every single day for this to be upheld. We see it as embedded racism where they question whether or not we have the qualifications, whether or not we should have the right to not share the data with them, and whether or not we have the right around the analysis and dissemination of that data. Unless we address the embedded systems of racism, we are going to replicate systems of inequity, and we will not see the change that we need for those who are not vulnerable because there's something wrong with us, or at risk because there's something wrong with us. We are at risk because we live in a country that has been effectively working to harm us, for my people, for more than 500 years. So I'm at risk because I'm in the United States, not because I'm a Native American. And until we make those system changes, until we have diverse workforces that can actually work within the communities and bring forward community voice, we're going to continue to replicate what has been done, and what has been done has been harmful.
Thank you so much, Abigail. I am sure you speak not only for Native communities, but for a lot of other communities in this country as well. So thank you for those words. Dylan, anything to add?
Yeah, no, it's really hard to follow Abigail. It's she's just one of the things I've really appreciated about this summit in particular is the opportunity to meet Abigail and learn from her, because I think we've all seen just what a force of nature she is already, which is amazing. And I'm really grateful for the opportunity to make sure that I'm paying attention to what she's saying, because there's lots to learn there. So thank you, Abigail. The only other thing that I think I would add to this particular discussion though too, is it's like, is making sure that we're talking about what are the actions that we want to make in turn. What is the action? How are we going to implement particular public health interventions that would keep people safe or reduce risk to different individuals? The reason I bring this up is that it's like back in the day when we were talking about biosurveillance and how to improve those sorts of things, there was lots of discussion about bringing lots of different data together in different places, and answers would mysteriously pop out of those to really kind of help us move forward in understanding the risk of different biological threats. And if we don't have a lot of our data systems embedded into what is the action that needs to happen, what is the evidence base that needs to be presented to discriminate what are the different actions that could be happening, and then the analytics that would provide that evidence base, the data systems that would enable that in terms of sharing, et cetera, it all flows down from there. And so making sure that we're clearly focusing on what do we want to do to keep people safe, and optimizing for those particular actions would be something that I would just wanted to make sure that we keep focused on, and not just get too wrapped around the axle on there's lots of really sparkly data out there that we could go after. We need to figure out how to optimize what those data are and how they could be used to help people go forward. So that would be the biggest thing I would add to this particular question.
Thank you. I really like the concept of starting with what are the big problems to solve, and then figuring out what information do we need to solve those problems, as opposed to starting with the shiny tools. There's been a lot of discussion about healthcare data, but what other types of data do we think we would need to pull together? What other types of information that may not come from healthcare do we need to pull into this conversation to really understand communities, populations, people, what they're going through, and how can we use the data that we have in combination with new streams of data to really understand how to prevent illness and death and other threats to people's health? I'm going to turn to Abigail first on this one.
Yeah, I really appreciated the opportunity to be part of the panel that Robert Johnson put together, that Dr. Christopher chaired, along with an effort that came out of Morehouse University for a data health equity tracker. We have to recognize that the social determinants of health, and as Daniel Dawes always says, the political determinants of health are so essential in the public health world. Unless we are addressing walkability, we're not going to make a difference. Unless we're addressing housing accessibility. So we have to be tying together these multitude of data sources to really create a full picture of the community. And it has to be done in a disaggregated way. When we have, and we always call in the American Indian Alaska Native community, we're often, we call ourselves the asterisk nation. That's because we're often the little asterisks down at the bottom of the data that says not statistically significant. Well, I say that's what embedded racism looks like, because I know with small population methodologies, you can come up with those data numbers. You simply didn't do the work to do it because it's easier and it costs more money to do. And so that lack of allocation of resources, that lack of just saying there wasn't enough data and not looking for how you do that has really caused an issue. And so we have to disaggregate data by those who are most at risk because of the country that we live in. And so it is an absolute responsibility for us to do that and to recognize that that data is also not objective, which is why you have to engage communities to ensure that you're getting the right information and the right story combined with all kinds of other types of information. Just a quick example of how data can be harmful is that around COVID-19 data early in the pandemic, in New Mexico, a hospital used the high rates of infection that they perceived in the Native community and removed babies, newborns. The moment they were born from their mothers, they took them from them because they said there was COVID risk. There was that misuse of data. And so unless we address all of those issues, data is not objective. It is not always used in a good way. It has to be community informed. It has to have all of the aspects of the political determinants of health, and it has to be pulled in from a multitude of resources that do what the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation did and what the Morehouse University Project did. And that is, it was shaped by community voices for community by community. And until we do that, we won't see change.
A strong argument for building from the ground up. Thank you so much, Abigail. Dylan, any thoughts on this? How other types of data?
No, you know, yeah, no, it's like, I feel like I need to like reshape all my thinking based on, the more I learn and listen to Abigail, the more I need to rejigger all my own thinking, which is wonderful. But the New Mexico story is a bit chilling, completely chilling in that respect. But it's one of these things where it's like, you know, the one comment I would make in this particular sense is that, you know, it's like, you know, in the capacities and capabilities that we're building from in the Center for Forecasting Outbreak Analytics, is we think that we're going to be able to provide a 10x benefit to the federal government in our value proposition. But really where we see we're going to have a 100x benefit is when we are able to provide these capabilities and do outreach to the different communities so that they can use them at the local level. And so we're in a process right now trying to do outreach and trying to think through how we actually can do that more effectively. Obviously, there's going to be a strong technological kind of component in terms of how we would actually do that at scale. But these are the exact kinds of conversations that we want to be in so that we can actually maximize the benefit of the capabilities that we're trying to build right now so that they're most useful at the local level, because that's where we see that the real benefit is really going to happen going forward. And so we would love to continue having those discussions with a range of people on this, in this group, and on various calls, and to get better feedback on how we can actually do that. And so I'm very eager to figure that out and try to understand what could be done in that space.
Yeah, I know, Jim, I know you worked in a local health department before you were, or a state health department before you were at the Office of the National Coordinator and at Amazon. Do you have any thoughts on how we can drive this kind of conversation at the local level and drive data and information at the local level that builds capacity to have those kinds of conversations that Abigail is talking about and connect those data streams?
Yeah, I mean, thanks Abigail so much for bringing up all those really critical points for when we think about these systems. It's so important. I know I'm more the technology voice here, but you know, technology really just needs to support what we're trying to do in public health that you have expressed so well. And, you know, I think, you know, when we think about some of the technology to support this, you know, some of the things that we really need to make sure that we're doing as we bring data together, there are ways to do it. You know, as Abigail said, sometimes it's a little more work, but you get better data when you do that. And, you know, we can query across data sets and bring data together without necessarily bringing all of that data together in one place. There are ways to bring in privacy-preserving record linkages, for example, to link data across federated data sets and allow public health the capacity to then query that data and look at what's going on and have better data where you don't necessarily run into those small cell size issues because you're bringing the data together in a way that doesn't allow for re-identification, and you can really look at the data better. So I think, you know, there are definitely some technology tools that we can bring together there. And there's some also really great tools available now that make it easier to ingest new data sources. When you think about trying to bring in a new data source into your analytics environment, there's a lot of, you know, transformation and, you know, things that you have to do to the data to clean it up. You know, with modern technology, there are tools now that can do all of that for you. And you know, we have to still, you know, make sure it's done in the right way and have some quality assurance processes, but we can start automating those and make it easier. And then we can start bringing together some non-traditional data sources. I think, you know, one of our issues is, you know, we tend to rely on data like electronic health records, where, you know, populations at risk might not have data there. And we need to make sure that we're bringing in data sources that are representative of our populations. And you know, there are lots of, I think, new and interesting tools that can help us do that and bring them together in a way that public health can actually take advantage of.
Yeah, I mean, from this conversation, one thing that I'm thinking about is that we really need local and state health departments in particular to really understand their own, the people and the populations that are living in their jurisdictions, and to be able to look at data and ask the questions in collaboration with the people and communities in their jurisdictions. And so that piece is so critical, and that involves a lot of other data that's not coming from the traditional sources. It involves knowing about, as you said, housing. It involves knowing about crowded housing conditions. It involves knowing about occupations. It involves knowing about LGBTQ people. It's about all the different types of ways that people live and challenges that people face in living that will inform our use of data and the questions that we ask. So how can we do that at the local or state level? How do we have those conversations and rework data systems to have that kind of consciousness? Abigail or Dylan, either one of you.
So I'm doing that work all the time. I love it. I, you know, definitely feel it is imperative to bring the message of where the embedded systems of racism are and offer the solutions, which include community engagement. I work with health departments across the country, engaging them and working towards systems change, everything from the way that they collect data to way that their epidemiologists are trained and the resources that they need. You can find a resource on best practices and data collection analyses and dissemination on my website, uihi.org, specifically for American Indians, Alaska Natives, but contains many different lessons that could be applied in other health departments. And so there are many of us out there working in this field, and definitely folks should check out the Equity Health Data Tracker out of Morehouse University that really takes those social determinants, those political determinants of health. There are resources and advocates and folks working on the ground. And what we need is people who will support us and stand with us. I often go into rooms, give this message, and afterwards I get a bunch of emails. It's like, good job. Tell me then, work it then. Let's make forward those plans. And there are people, I know thousands of them across the country, who are waiting for that kind of allyship, that kind of an accomplice within county health departments, to state departments, to the federal government. This is our time. This is our opportunity. We will see change if we make the move now.
Thank you so much. Dylan, anything to add to this?
No, I mean, it's like trying to follow Abigail is just like, you know, it's like fraught with problems.
Sorry, I keep asking you to do that.
I'm perfectly willing to be in that, but it's just like Abigail is amazing. And it's like, you know, it's like, just count me in. It's like, Stan, what we would definitely want to learn from you in terms of how we can actually maximize the capabilities of the new center we're building to move forward with you and stand with you in those capacities. And so I look forward to collaborating with you going forward and finding meaningful ways that we can actually do those things together.
Which also speaks to the type of workforce we need in the state and local health departments to be able to reach out to communities and work together with them, in addition to having the data science capabilities all put together. Our last question is the need for data granularity reflecting local jurisdictional subgroup and population group distinctions is important to the democratization of data. What data do we have now, and what data are needed to maximize the improvements in public health?
That's and a Annie, if I could just let you all know, we just have 1 minute left. So
okay, we have 1 minute left. So I'll offer the mic to whoever wants to speak first. Jim, you have your.
Oh no, I was going to say Abigail should go for this one.
Okay.
For me, data disaggregation is one of the most key things that we need to be working towards. And when that data is disaggregated, to ensure that community voices are doing the interpretation of it. And I will speak specifically to the American Indian Alaska Native population, because tribal public health authority is not upheld. They often will not share information that would build beneficial movements towards addressing health inequities, not only in their communities, but in the communities in which they live, because they haven't had that respectful relationship from the areas in which they live. And that is another opportunity for meaningful change. But data disaggregation and done in a way that, again, don't disaggregate it because you think you know how to do it. Engage with your communities to ensure it's done properly so that it doesn't cause continued harm.
Thank you so much. So I'm glad we've been able to address this. This panel has represented everything from the community all the way up to the very large scale technological and forecasting perspective. So I hope we can integrate all this data across this whole spectrum and start at the ground and then provide useful information up at the federal level too. So thank you everybody on our panel so much. Really appreciate
it. Thank you so much. As you all can see, the panels are quite dynamic, so thank you. So we're gonna pause now again and take a quick poll to hear from all of you in the audience. And our second poll question is, a recent Robert Wood Johnson Foundation National Commission report on equity-centered data noted, we have an opportunity now to create a data infrastructure that is centered on equity and that creates fair and just opportunities for everyone. What do you consider the single biggest challenge to achieving an equitable data infrastructure? Again, this is select one option. And I want to remind you there is an other. So if you have more to say and you don't like the single choices, please put your answer into chat. We all have the Jeopardy music in our heads now. Seeing some good thoughts coming into chat. We should have our results here momentarily. And here we go. So it looks like fostering authentic engagement of communities in the generation, use, or interpretation of health data is the lead, with a close second on the missing data on key demographics such as gender, race, sexual identity, and other subgroups. So thank you all for your engagement. And we will now move to our next spotlight. I'm pleased to introduce our spotlight speaker, Dr. Bryant Cross, who is Chief Medical Informatics Officer at the State of Washington Department of Health. Bryant, so great to see you. Take it away.
Hello, everybody. And I know I have a short amount of time, so I'll try to move really quickly. I'm excited. We could have talked about a ton of different things out here in Washington, and how we led in the initial response to our migration to the cloud, to our pioneering work in fire and smart health cards. But I'm going to spend our time doing a deep dive in one example spotlight of exposure notifications, which I think shows the innovation, engagement, and equity that's possible when you embrace a new technology. Next slide. So in Washington, we refer to exposure notifications by its short-term WA notify. And we had a large ad campaign and social media campaign rolling out this technology. It, for those of you who don't know it, EN is the smart phone technology that uses Bluetooth, and we migrated towards a Google and Apple API standard that's been released around the world now. And it's free, it's private, it's anonymous, it's cryptographically protected. There's no way for it to be used to track you. So you can't, it doesn't know who you are, where you are, or who you've been near, but it does keep these cryptographic random keys so that it can be used to do exposure notifications. In Washington, we released the technology in more than 30 languages in the app and more than 42 languages in the FAQs and what to do next pages. We also made the technology available to our tribal partners and local health jurisdictions within Washington State so they could directly access the API without having to go through the Department of Health. After following Abigail, it's always hard to follow Abigail, but I want to remind her that we had a representative from Urban Indian Health Institute on our advisory committee. So that as we rolled this technology out, even before it went live, we had input from our communities. Next slide, please. I'm not going to spend a lot of time on this. You can read all the words when you get a copy of the slides, but as a reminder, this is how it works. It's really at its heart a capacity that's crowdsourced, that's happening at the ground level and is an exchange between two independent phones, no central database, nothing needed except turning on the Bluetooth and doing these short bursts of sharing the random keys between the phones. It only works as everybody is enrolling and using it. I'll talk about our adoption in a minute. And then when one of those two people turns up to be positive, activating and turning their phone on to look back into their logs of who they've been near, share the log of that they've been broadcasting with a central national server, in our case, hosted at APHL and running on Microsoft Azure for the United States, then that way other people's phones can random at intervals check to see if they've been near a positive case. And then running the algorithm solely on the person's phone, there's no central algorithm on that phone to determine whether or not their exposure was long enough or close enough to warrant a warning. Next slide, please. So here's the adoption curve, and it's one of the most exciting things I've ever seen in public health, of bringing on over 1 million participants in the first 7 days. It was just extraordinary. Now, after our 1 year anniversary, we did a second push availability notification, and it bumped our total participation rate over 3 million, which is nearly half of the cell phones in the state of Washington, which is just amazing to think about the kind of reach and engagement that we have from the community. It's not just a matter of having it. The health department has to engage with the technology and actually leverage it. So, and we've done that by making incremental improvements over time that I'll talk about in the next slide. And as a result, we've been able to have over 83,000 activations. And you can see the blue line is the number of codes that we sent out to people. And the green and orange line are the number of codes that have actually been activated. And prior to Omicron, you could actually see a lot more of the detail in those lines, but Omicron has kind of changed the scale and made it until recent days where you can actually see that effect of people using the technology. And looking at the curve, you can see that the pattern as different phases, waves, and variants have been released. That first spike, which looks much higher than it should, is because we did a reach back and issued in the very first day that we launched the ability to text out the activation codes rather than waiting for contact tracers and case investigators to hand out the codes one at a time. We did a 14-day historical reach out of all the positives that it came in. So there's quite a spike there. But each of the others reflect the winter surge, the Delta surge, and now the Omicron surge. Next slide, please. So one of the things I want to talk about is that when a new technology comes out, one has to evaluate it, keep iterating and improving on it. And we've been fortunate into working with collaborators of other states rolling this technology out, and our university partner, the University of Washington, thinking through how best to leverage this technology. And one of the things that we've done that we'll be sharing research papers on shortly is evaluating within the exposure notification, what are the different levels of activation that can occur? 15 minute, 30 to 45 minute. And then we recently added a new level that was a sub CDC threshold for activation. Next slide, please. I'm gonna skip over this in the interest of time. Next slide. So here you're seeing the end result of the subsequent exposure notifications that the algorithm popped up on people's phone as a result of different tiers of exposures. And you can see, obviously, the 30 minute exposure results in more notifications, pop-ups going out, warning people that they had a significant exposure and should monitor for symptoms and go get tested. The 15 minute threshold is that, is that traditional time point, the CDC criteria. We added recently a self-reported or self requested, user requested component that speeds up the time for that activation to go out, not waiting for the lab result. And then a sub threshold of people who are below the criteria getting an advisory note that they didn't meet the criteria, but they should be warned and on the lookout. And having this kind of actionable information that we can distribute out to the population in real time, helping them to understand what they can do next, has been really valuable. Next slide, please. So this is the last slide. I just want to reiterate that this wouldn't have been possible if we tried to do this all by ourselves. We had actually headed down a path of a custom solution. And by instead partnering with our partners, Apple and Google and Microsoft and APHL and MITRE, we've been able to come up with a product that's so much better than we would have done on our own. And by evaluating with our academic partners, we're able to keep making improvements and show the public health impact that this new tool has had. But it really, really works when we're doing it and sharing these innovations out across the rest of the states. And not every state has adopted this technology yet. I think that we should be. And not every state has adopted it with the same kind of engagement. I think that there are iterations and everybody can continuously try to improve upon. So thank you so much for your time. And next slide, last slide. Please let me know if you have any questions. And I hope this served as an inspiration of what is possible when people work together with open APIs and open technologies. Thanks, Judy.
Yeah, thank you, Brian. And now we're going to transition to our third panel presentation. And this panel will help us answer how to get to actionable data. Leading this panel is Dr. Chris Box, who is the Indiana State Health Commissioner. So Chris, thanks for joining us, and I'll turn it over to you. And you're on mute. We couldn't get through this without one of them.
Yeah, exactly. I had to be the first to do it, right? Thanks, Judy. Our panelists today include Dr. Terry Cullen from the Pima County Health Department, Dr. Karen Remley from the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, and Dale Sanders from Health Catalyst. I want to thank all of them for joining us today. Our objective with this panel is to describe the context and mechanisms that accelerate or potentially inhibit efficient digital and secure data exchange in real time across sectors and jurisdictions to prevent disease and promote health at the individual and the community level. So first question, the magnitude and the complexity of the transformation needed to modernize and sustain the public health data systems of the future present many numerous opportunities, but also many challenges. In your experience, how can public health leaders, agencies, organizations support the transformation needed to modernize our data systems and ensure the high quality, accessible, secure, and real-time data? Terry, I think your perspective as a local public health leader is invaluable. Would you like to lead us off?
Yeah, I'd love to. So I now am a local public health leader for a county of 1 million people. We have the longest border with Mexico, and we also have two tribal organizations, reservations within our land. So I want to really hearken that I'm so grateful for the people that have gone before, you know, not just in all of history, but in the last 2 hours. I want to first start by saying the work at a local level is really hard and requires commitment, and it requires a long-term commitment. And I think we need to remember that this is not going to happen quickly. And we need to remind ourselves, our politicals, our communities that we have along, that we are making this commitment. COVID has given us this amazing insight into what has happened in our community. Inequity is everywhere. And what we have decided at our department is to really use a foundational platform of equity and ethical decision-making with everything we do. I will say we didn't start there, but we ended up there quite rapidly when we started looking at our race and ethnicity data and realized we couldn't do the kind of data analysis that we needed. So respectful engagement with our community, a clear mission, including engagement with our tribes, which we are lucky enough to have. I was actually worked for Indian Health Service for 25 years. So I have a relationship. I understand the public health authority of tribal nations. I think that that is a very unique perspective that we haven't done a great job of illustrating and activating. I do want to make one comment on what was just presented. All I want to say is that works great notification if you have a smartphone. If you don't have a smartphone, you are left out. And it is potentially a great example of the unintentional consequences of not imposing an ethical lens on an equity lens on decision making. For us to move this forward, close community collaboration, working with closely with our CBOs, an understanding that public health data is not a secondary use of data, it is a primary use of data. So the reliance solely on EHR data pushes us to the background. And what we need to say from a public health perspective as we're looking to get data that's actionable is that, hey, you know what, we're at the table with you. And that may require EHRs to change. I know there's always this thing, public health needs to integrate with EHRs. I would kind of be a little controversial here and say, perhaps EHRs need to be modified to meet us. And that means appropriate technology reflecting what we have in the community. We just stood up a side example. We just stood up a large FEMA test site. You have to be able to print your registration. We have many households that don't have printers. So we are scrambling in the last 48 hours to figure out what is the workaround there. We should have known that earlier. We weren't aware of that as a requirement. The fact that multiple data sets are out there, and people have talked about this, they are really critical, multiple data sets that we collect that other people don't have insight into and visibility and need to have that. And finally, the one thing I would lead people with, and I keep mentioning this is, you know, so playbooks are highly effective, and the development of a playbook for local health departments, regardless of if they're small, moderate, or large, reflective of what we know their constraints are, especially as they relate to human and fiscal resources, is critical. That is the way we will accelerate this work, by laying out, here's the foundational steps. You could do it from a capability maturity model. Here's the seven domains that need to be addressed. And here's how you go from level one to level five, with the recognition that at the end, we have a learning public health system that is responsible and responsive to the needs of the community. Thanks.
Thanks so much, Terry. So many good points all in that one question. I know one thing you did mention is this is not going to happen quickly. And I know that our next speaker, Dale, and mentioned already, this is a decade's worth of work that we need to even get where we want to be. So Dale, your thoughts on supporting this needed transformation?
Well, first I'm going to pile on to what Abigail said. Right? We had the Black Lives Matter movement. We had the Me Too movement. We need the Indigenous and Native American movement. I grew up around the Navajo, Hopi, Zuni, and Ute tribes, and we owe it to rebuild those cultures. And public health, of course, is fundamental to that. So I come at this as sort of a data guy, right? But I've been a healthcare CIO and chief analytics officer at a number of places. I went into the vendor space a few years ago to try and improve things from that side. By the way, I'm also affiliated with a company called Intelligent Medical Objects. And I joined IMO after working at Health Catalyst in the analytics space because data quality in healthcare is abysmal. And I thought, I'm going to work on the taxonomy and the terminology and the fundamental formats of data to try to affect change in healthcare. And then COVID, you know, did, it put a spotlight on how poorly organized we are with our data quality and our things like LOINC, right? LOINC is kind of hard to use. It's not very effective. It's not well adopted. ICD is not always very specific. SNOMED is really hard to use. So we need to step back, and I'm hoping that CDC and ONC can take a leadership role in first establishing meaningful common taxonomies that we all use from the very beginning, right? That's the foundation. And I'll reference an organization called GS1. They are the barcode UPC standard for the world in the retail industry. So anytime, or not even just retail, they're also affecting barcodes in healthcare. So anytime a company needs a barcode, you go to this company, GS1, you file for it, and it becomes a standard. We need something similar to that beyond the National Library of Medicine, by the way, that functions as the national standard for our taxonomies and for our vocabularies and things. I'll say one more thing, then I'll pause here, Chris. I'm a big believer that CDC and the STILTs need what I would call a public health data operating system. We need to step back from the history that we have with the current information systems and rebuild in a modern way. And the cloud vendors have made the build out of these data operating systems a near commodity. So it's entirely doable, friends. It's entirely doable thanks to the cloud vendors. And then we work on what I call mindset, skill set, tool set. Mindset means we break down the barrier between population health on the care delivery side and public health and the public health side. There's no division between those two anymore. We have to stop that. No other countries operate like that. The skill set is building the skills in the public health community to take advantage of data. And then, of course, the tool set is that foundational data operating system that I mentioned. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dale. Great comments. I know I found myself many times throughout this pandemic thinking, why is each individual hospital system and each individual state developing their own connection to each and every one of these EHRs, many of which we share and we have in common, rather than tapping onto something that was already kind of built at a national level?
Yeah.
Go ahead. I'm sorry.
One last thing. Healthcare.gov is a great example of a federally sponsored and maintained platform that the states leverage to their benefit as well. And the states have all sorts of autonomy and security. But the platform is funded and maintained by the federal government. And it's a great role model. We can do the same thing for public health.
Great. Karen, what would you like to add to this question? Oh, I think you're on mute too. I'm sorry. I started that.
My fault. I reminded myself multiple times and still didn't do it. I think hearing Teresa say that public health and healthcare need does not bring public health along, but do it together is critically important. And the words I thought about when I read this question is we need to be not public health data snobs to say there's only one way to collect the data and our way is the right way. And that's the only way we'll get it published and be in the MMWR. We need to have humility to figure out what don't we know and what are we not collecting. And we need to think more broadly. And the example I will use is early on in COVID, we were learning in my day job at the center at CDC, people with disabilities is under my purview. And we were hearing from people with disabilities that they were being deprioritized for care, especially people with intellectual disabilities or significant mobility issues. And we went to try and look to find the information to validate that, because many of you remember the high-risk condition list for not only who's at high risk, but who's going to get prioritized for vaccination. And we don't collect the data that way. We don't collect it, didn't collect it at the CDC, didn't collect it through healthcare systems. So really had to kind of start from scratch and think about how we do it. I'm happy to hear everybody talk about all of the racism, the structural components that occur. They are all intersected when you look at people with disabilities. So, you know, we know that Native Americans have the highest disability rate of any population in our country. We rural people of color. So it has a significant impact, and we need to always be thinking about not just one group, but how those groups work together. That's sort of those social determinants, environmental determinants of health, and how we can change the way we collect data. I was happy to see who's on because we just learned that the US core data set for interoperability version 3, we've been able to put forth collecting demographic data on disability, and it's out for public comment. So I encourage you all to think about that. And one of the reasons why I say demographic data is if you talk to people with disabilities, they consider that a part of who they are, not a medical condition. And so, you know, again, it's hearing people and being humble enough to think about their perspective. So we did a lot of catch up, and we still have a lot more catch up to do in this area. And I think it just demonstrates that we need to think about other ways to collect data, other ways to receive it, and how to really listen to the community, which is what everyone else is saying. Thank you.
Thanks, Karen. Realistically, there are cultural, political, economic, social, and technological factors that can support or can hinder transformation needed to support modernization. From your experience, how can we or must we navigate these contextual dynamics? Dale, I was going to start with you because you made the comment in one of our emails that you were once known as a data technologist, but now you're more valuable as a data psychologist, which I think gets to the heart of this question.
Yeah, again, thanks to the cloud vendors, Chris, these platforms are largely a commodity now, right? I used to be well known for my ability to engineer these things. I don't know anything about it anymore. I just turn on a service at AWS or Google or Microsoft, and I've got everything that took me years to develop. So the truth is, you know, what I've learned over the years is that the way you govern, establish standards for data, and then the way you utilize data and people's willingness to accept data to affect their change in behavior and things, which is essentially what we're trying to do. All of that is super important. If you look at the HIEs, for example, I would say one of the reasons that it failed was because largely has failed. I mean, they're better than they used to be, but they've never really lived up to their potential. And I think it's because we flew right past the governance, the adoption, and the economic sustainability and motives for it, right? So these soft issues around data now are way more important than the technical issues. We can solve the technical issues, but we have to address governance, data standards, economic sustainability. And then how do you affect people and their behavior when you want them to change in the face of data, right? And I think we've all seen what happened with COVID. I mean, the truth is, you can force facts on people all day long, but if it violates their sense of identity, they're going to entrench. So we have to be smarter about the way we approach people with data, with nudges rather than forces, right?
Great words. And I watched with great interest and adopted as a state here many of the recommendations that came out about the best ways to approach people with regards to vaccination and testing and contact tracing. Karen, working at the federal level, I'm sure that you've had a perspective and heard from a lot of different states and territories about how they're navigating these dynamics. What would you add to this conversation?
You know, it's interesting because I was state health official in Virginia for two governors, and I think that was more realistic in terms of what I've learned. But I think one of the things we have to do that's a cultural issue is public health has always been, and I said we needed to be humble, but we also appear very humble when we go to ask for services or advocate for our agencies with our governors and our mayors. And we've really got to say, we need to innovate. We need to have the funding to be able to innovate and think about how we use technology. And we will stumble a few times and, you know, and learn from that. But if you don't give us that opportunity, we will never get there. When I helped Virginia 2 years ago try and get their testing numbers up, and one of the things we realized is I had been the state health official 10 years before, and every year we asked for money for a new server. 10 years later, the new server was still not there and the data just couldn't update fast enough. And, you know, I called the governor and said, I think if you just invest in this server, which was like, I don't know, $100,000, you can go from being 49th to 30th kind of like within a week because your data will now be entered in a more real time. And I say that it to just illustrate the point that we really have to embrace and then think about how to communicate that innovation, that room for error, that room for growing within public health to our stakeholders.
Great. Terry, what would you like to add? Anything?
Yeah, I'd love to follow up on that. You know, I think there was previous discussion about social determinants of health and someone, I don't recall who it is, threw in the political determinants of health. So what we know is that at the local level, especially while there is national funding and state funding that comes on, you have to have the support of your jurisdictional governance, regardless of what that model is. And I know for us, what we've really try to do, and not to say this is easy, to make public health nonpartisan, to basically remind people that improving the health status of the community has an economic benefit, a fiscal benefit, a business benefit, a school benefit, a household benefit. And so some of this is to change the dialogue because there is a dependency on funding because that is the core. And Karen, your example about the server is a perfect example that has been replicated throughout the country in many local health departments. So to have that buy-in and to be clear that there are metrics that the elected officials and the politicals and the funders can hold you accountable for, I think is critical. As we move into the next stage of public health 2.0, 3.0, whatever you want to call it, we need to hold ourselves accountable. We need to say, these are the metrics that we are developing from a technical and a data equity, lots of different venues to make sure that we remain a good investment. I think that the onus is on us, but we have to do it in partnership with our community. And we have to activate the community to understand that.
Great words. Last question. We only have about 3 to 4 minutes. But in considering how we ensure the availability and use of data to drive action, is there any final observation or recommendation that's important in preventing disease and promoting health equity amongst all of our populations and within all communities? I know, Karen, you talked about an example that you had, and I think, Terry, you also had one.
Yeah. Real quickly, we heard in the summer that children were more likely to have diabetes after COVID infection in both Europe and then heard anecdotally from clinicians around the country. In going to my CDC colleagues and say, how do we look into this? It was going to be a year-long study with case control and, you know, just the classic public health way of doing it. And I said, you know, if this is true, we need to let parents know now because it has a big impact as vaccine became available. So they can have that decision making and what they do, and they understand what the risk might be to their children. Long story short, we used IQVIA and Health Verity. Health Verity, as an example, has 187 million unique patients in that record, and it looks at medical claims, it looks at health, electronic health records, pharmacy claims, many other things, and it does use that privacy preserving record linkage to be able to look and identify traits. Now, was it hard to do? Yes, because it takes only a few people who know how to look at these huge data sets and churn it through. So you have to develop that expertise within the CDC. But we were able to, long story short, in a very short time period, publish a MMWR saying that the hazards ratio was 2.6 times greater to develop diabetes within a month post-COVID infection in children less than 18. Than children who did not have COVID, and also comparing to children that had other viral respiratory illnesses before COVID. So actionable information that went out to the public at a much faster time span than we were used to doing before.
Awesome. Terry, last word.
Yeah, I just have a few examples, but I also want to praise these public-private philanthropic partnerships because we were lucky enough to benefit from one with the CDC and the U.S. Digital Services and how to get data from testing in nursing homes, long-term cares, huge issue because of their prime initial just give a shout out to them. Their Prime initiative, we were their alpha and beta site for simple reports. It has transformed our ability to get data to the state and to us. There's also the use, as you guys know, of SVI, but also the COVID Vulnerability Index and multiple dashboards. And we've been lucky enough to work with some of our partners in health and some other learning collaboratives that resolve to save lives that have really helped us accelerate what we would have been incapable of doing on our own. And so I just think this transition of data to action is critical. The one other comment I want to make is there was a comment in the chat about racism and equity. And I want to say I'm lucky. I live in a county that declared racism and socioeconomic injustice as a public health crisis. It took us a year. We worked closely with our community and we got full endorsement of that at our county level. So that gave us a structure to do a lot of this work. Thanks.
It's fabulous. Thank you, everyone. Appreciate all of your input. Very valuable.
Yes, thank you so much. Wonderful panel. And now I'm really pleased to transition to our next spotlight speaker, Dr. Nirav Shah. He is the Chief Medical Officer of ShareCare and will spotlight accelerators of actionable data. Nirav, over to you.
Thank you so much. It's so great to be here and look forward to continuing the conversation in the chat box afterwards as well. I know we're a little over time, but I hope I can excite you and provoke you. If I don't get some folks upset, I'm not doing my job. So a lot of disclosures, but these are also relevant experience relative to what I'm going to talk about. And what I wanted to start talking about was about the data that we followed. And you all know this story with COVID, that all of these metrics made sense at one point during the pandemic. But new infections are now less relevant if people are using home antigen tests. And it's a bit like the guy who lost his keys across the street, but is looking under the street light and therefore will never find them, right? So for the last few weeks, I wanted to follow how many healthcare workers are out with COVID. And as the top right example shows from a large system in California, we were quite worried in this one hospital, but it's getting better now. Or what wastewater is showing us, as the bottom right graph shows, which is a much more valid measure when lab-based testing is no longer relevant because, again, COVID activity in the community doesn't reflect what you're finding in just a single lab anymore with all the home-based testing. And maybe we want to follow other data points, other metrics, like daily average fever counts. And so we have to rely on new data sources. This is an article from the New York Times last week, where they use data from a company called Kinsa, which has distributed millions of smart thermometers across the US, many in Title I schools, to the most vulnerable students, often living in multi-generational families or with poorer access to healthcare. And so you can see how they use the data and how they were able to break it up over time. And what's important is that such data are much more timely. Here's an example using that same data set compared to the CDC data, which publishes only aggregated data from the prior week. So CDC reported data is about 12 days old by the time of publication on Fridays, and we can do better. And when you have the right data, as Dylan George suggests, let's inform the public, right? This is an example from September of 2020, which went viral and brought home to many Americans for the first time how COVID was spreading over the last few months. And it was made by a bunch of volunteer ex-Google and other public health technologists. And I know Dylan George and others are gonna do more like this, but this kind of thing that you tweet out or you put on TikTok can spread the message in ways that we need to do as public health professionals now, in ways that we aren't used to doing. You know, earlier, Abigail Echo Hawk talked about the excuse that there's just not enough data. And she's right, that is an excuse. This is an example of something called the Community Wellbeing Index that aggregates over 600 different data points around the social determinants of health for over 99% of counties in the US. Things like walkability, bikeability, housing, with the needed data granularity and disaggregation to support local efforts. And so time and again, what we're seeing is that there are many private companies doing the work of public health, we need to start looking and partnering with them. This is an example for from other rich sources of data. Over $40 billion was invested last year in digital health startups who have incredible data and impact. I'll give you an example. These are companies in substance abuse, addiction treatment. Boulder Care, for example, has telehealth addiction treatment and keeps people engaged for 70% at 6 months and 64% at 1 year, which means that an evidence-based approach that is highly effective from a public health perspective on a vulnerable population can happen. And by the way, they have data about these people, and 25% of their thousands of people live in rural areas. 80% are low income on Medicaid, and at least 18% never enrolled in a medication addiction program before. So folks, there's money out there. It's not necessarily where you look. It doesn't go to public health all the time, but why shouldn't we use what others are doing for the benefits of local public health? I'll speak briefly about federated learning. This is an approach Dr. Brian talked earlier about the Apple Google exposure notification, which protects privacy and security and allows public health to function. This is another example of federated learning where we can share learnings without sharing the data. So what I've learned is, frankly, technology has solved a lot of these problems. It may have not reached us where we're still thinking of servers or on-premise expensive investments, or maybe moving to the cloud when everyone else has already moved to the edge. There are things that we can do, and folks are out there willing and able to help us in public health if we ask. So what have I learned? Well, we need to measure what matters and communicate it in ways to the public that they can understand. We have to partner with the private sector and technologists who've solved the problems of privacy and security, and support folks like Ken Mandel at the Computational Health Informatics Program at Boston Children's, or Rick Hawes at the US Digital Service, or Anish Chopra, or Bala Hota, formerly at Rush, or the gang working with Dylan George. Because I think we know who's doing great work. We just need to step up and say, we want what Dylan's building, as opposed to anything else. So I'll stop there. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Nirav. Really appreciate it. And so now we have one last poll question that we're going to turn to before we go into our last panel. So if we can pull up the poll question quickly. Data modernization is a complex and exciting opportunity to improve health and wellness for everyone, everywhere. What area of data modernization feels most critical to your day-to-day role? And again, you choose only one of the answers listed here, or you can add into chat if you want to expand on an answer that we don't give you a choice for. And we should be getting answers here in just a moment. And here we go. Wow, looks like almost a tie there. 30% said strengthening and unifying critical infrastructure for a response-ready public health ecosystem. And number one, just a little ahead of that, was accelerating data into action to improve decision-making and protect health. So thank you all for your engagement in that. And now we're going to transition to our final panel, investing in a diverse and inclusive. It's the why does actionable intelligence matter to people, communities, public health, and the private sector? Sorry, looking at the wrong notes here. And so at this point, I'm going to turn over to Jamie Pina. Dr. Pina is the Vice President of Public Health Data Modernization at ASTO. Jamie, I'll turn it to you. Thank you.
Thank you, Judy. It's really great to be here. Hi, everyone. I hope you're having a wonderful day. Today, our panelists include Dr. Kimberly Repp from the Washington County Public Health Department, Dr. Marlene Wolf, Assistant Professor of Emory University, and Dr. Lauren Smith, Chief Health Equity and Strategy Officer from the CDC Foundation. And our objective today for this panel is to consider the practical examples of actionable intelligence's value add across diverse stakeholders with different goals and needs. We're looking to understand the improvements to health and wellness, as well as how actionable intelligence can encourage prosperity. So I'm going to kick things off with an initial question and we'll go from there. A lot has been shared today about the value of data and its utility. The COVID-19 pandemic has demonstrated how health is tied to many sectors across our communities. So is the opioid crisis. When considering the value of data to people, communities, health, public health, and the private sector, what are some specific examples of actionable data and why do they matter? And I'll open to our panelists for comment.
Hi, my name is Kim Rep. I'm the Chief Epidemiologist for Washington County, Oregon. And I was very surprised. We developed our own suicide surveillance system in Washington County that collected near real-time data for each suicide. It was filled in by our medical examiners who did the death investigation. And not only did that not have us waiting 2 years for National Violent Death Reporting System data, we were able to take it to the private businesses, all of our partners, our healthcare partners, and say, this is what's happening. You are seeing people that are imminently suicidal and you don't know it. And we actually saw a tremendous amount of change for healthcare policies, law enforcement policy changes, because they finally had the data they needed to make those changes. So it made a huge, huge difference in our community to actually have data that they could work off of.
Thanks, Dr. Rep. Dr. Wolf.
Hi, everyone. Yes. That's an incredible example of looking to a little bit different source of data to be able to act much quicker. So I'm an assistant professor at Emory. I'm an environmental engineer and environmental microbiologist. So for me, I look at this totally different source of data than we often look at, which is the environment, to think not only about exposure, you know, what we're exposed to and how that makes us sick, but also what we can infer from the environment about the burden of disease in the community and then have actionable information. And so we've heard it referenced a couple times today throughout this summit, which is very exciting, but we've been working a lot on developing systems for wastewater monitoring for COVID and now extending that into looking at other diseases which may not be reportable, which may face many of the challenges that we faced during the beginning of the pandemic and during surge times like we've been experiencing recently, where accessing testing, clinical diagnostic testing is difficult. Important because it's important for individuals to know that they're sick. That can inform our behavior and treatment and so many things, but it doesn't give us the public health community perspective that we can access through wastewater in an unbiased way, accessing everyone in the community who uses the toilet. So I think that's, you know, my really powerful experience during this pandemic has been to see how this system has matured into something where we can rapidly, with one sample, test an entire community and say, this is the occurrence of disease that we are dealing with, and then respond quickly. And so for me, actionable means that quickly ascertaining the situation, just as Kim just pointed out, much, much quicker data, but then also having the appropriate data to respond to say, we know that this is an accurate representation of what the whole community is facing. We can segment parts of the community by focusing on certain areas of the wastewater system. And so we can match the public health response rapidly to the particular needs of that community.
Thanks, Dr. Wolf. Dr. Smith?
I would just echo what they've said and sort of tie it together with some of the other threads of the conversations we've heard so far today, which is around who has access to that data and how is it being shared, and what kind of story or narrative, as Dr. Christopher talked about, is being added to that data as it's being distributed. And I'm sure we're going to get into that, but I think the information that Dr. Wolf just shared is so fascinating. And then the question is, how can it be accessible and digestible and usable by the local communities to do something different, to respond real time to the information that she's giving us an example of?
Thanks, Dr. Smith. Agreed. And I'll just note for those who maybe are unfamiliar with the concept of actionable intelligence that typically we're referring to information and data that we both receive quickly and can take action on quickly. The time frame that I typically think of is somewhere between 48 and 72 hours, but that could change depending on who you ask. So throughout the pandemic, businesses, healthcare, the transportation sector, education, and other sectors needed real-time data to make quick decisions to protect their diverse communities. Considering that diversity, what have you found contributes to successful data utilization?
Well, I'll start with one thing is that the data is relevant and to how and what the different communities, say for this point, the business or the transportation sector needs to be doing. And so I think we've heard in all of the prior panels this issue around even just nuances of what information is collected and how it's reported can make the meaning so different in terms of the timeliness and when people can actually make use of it.
Great point. Thank you, Dr. Smith.
In local public health, we find that our institutions are, whether they're community organizations or law enforcement, they are not aware that we have the data. So part of it is just making aware all those individuals, hey, we have this information and maybe people don't use our website. So that's not the best way to communicate. I mean, often I think it's building relationships before you need to share the data is what actually is helpful because you'll present the data, you'll have it, you'll be able to share it with the community members. But if you don't have those relationships ahead of time, they're not going to start listening to you just because you have data.
That's a great point. Yeah. Thanks, Dr. Rupp. Yeah, Dr. Wolf.
Absolutely. I think, you know, for using the wastewater as an example, this really new type of data that we're presenting to communities and asking them to understand something that is not what we've done before, it's been an interesting process because we started working on this about 2 years ago now, saying, oh, it looks like this virus, which is just starting to spread, we see that it's present, it's being shed in the feces of people who are infected, right, in addition to saliva and sputum. And so we think we'll be able to reliably track that in the wastewater. You know, that's a great idea. And so we weren't sure at that point if it would work, right? This was a new wastewater monitoring is something that's been done before, but not really for respiratory viruses. So we had to kind of prove in stages, this is going to work. We can detect this in the wastewater. Now we're showing over time that this is a really good reflection of cases in the community. Now we're showing, oh, during last winter's surge, for example, that as we maxed out our testing capacity for clinical testing, we didn't max out our testing capacity in the wastewater. And so we were able to see the peak went a little bit higher than was detected in the clinical cases in some of our areas. But, you know, at that point, we're still in the process of showing the community, showing public health officials, showing, you know, community members that this works and is effective. And now during this past surge, we have had people coming proactively to us and saying, you know, we need this data. Where's the wastewater data? Can you help us explain it? Can you help us understand it? So I think that it's really important that we have sort of open minds to these sorts of new data streams that can provide us with really actionable data, but that we do have to put the work in to making sure that our communities understand. And now we've gotten to the point where, you know, we had an MMWR article come out last week kind of describing the early detection of Omicron in wastewater. That trust has really, you know, been a process, but now we're able to provide it as an actionable service.
And just to build on that, you could imagine the kinds of ways that business or folks that run the transportation authorities might use the kind of information that you're describing, Marlene, to then be able to predict what do we think will be happening, you know, in for foot traffic, for people coming into restaurants, you know, et cetera, based on the information that you are talking about.
Absolutely. And we've seen like hospitals use this information, for example, to anticipate their staffing needs. So it could be used in the same way to sort of anticipate what we're going to see reflected in other parts of the economy. And then also, you know, to make decisions about, you know, what kind of treatments we offer, you know, if we're choosing what to make available and what to use as first line treatments in hospitals based on what variants are circulating, can use this data to make all of those decisions that are important to be made rapidly.
Thanks, Dr. Wolf. Thanks, everyone. I'm sort of hearing a thread here, which is that determining the right questions to answer with these kinds of actionable data becomes a real focus in the sense that we have lots of data available and selecting what questions we want to respond to using these new novel data sources, I think is really one of our challenges. Does anyone on the panel have feedback about how you select the answers that you will try to respond to using these new and novel data sources?
In public health and local public health, we actually kind of have to go it around the opposite way. What data do we have that aren't 2 years old right now? And what question can those answer? Because unfortunately, in that scenario, we are dealing with, we have very, very few data sources that are, as what we would call for this panel, actionable. So it's really limited. I mean, wastewater is an outstanding example, but we've had to build everything ourselves in order to answer specific questions and get the data quickly. So we've had to kind of reverse engineer it, but that's just the government sector.
Dr. Smith, Dr. Wolf, do you have any feedback about how you generate those important questions that these new novel data sources can respond to?
Well, I think I would go back to some of the conversations again that we've been, the themes that we've been hearing all morning, which is to have a sound understanding of what community priorities are, and that's a broad brush, but knowing that going into it, you can sort of look to see which of those questions are relevant or able to be answered by the kind of information you have. But it's essential to have the community at the table and sort of setting what those priorities are. And just to, you know, to recall what, you know, Abigail Echohawk and, you know, Gail Christopher talked about, that's an essential part of ensuring that the questions are going to be reflective of what's meaningful to the community.
Agreed. Thanks, Dr. Smith.
I'll add one thing here, which is I think that, you know, obviously I'm an academic, so I come at this from that angle and thinking about research and development of these tools that can be used, but we're working closely with local, state, and federal government levels to develop recommendations to implement programs and working with industry as well. And so I think that's important to think about, you know, how can we create this into like a sustainable solution? And so part of that is when we're developing a new tool like this is to say, well, let's make sure it meets the needs of the community, right? There's the obvious immediate need of COVID. And so it was very easy. That was a great place to start. It's really been helpful. But then now we're actively asking all of our community stakeholders, what else do we need to monitor? You know, what else do we need to look for? And so we're working on that now, and we've gotten feedback in the way we've chosen our next, you know, infectious outbreak diseases to pursue has been based on that feedback, looking at respiratory syncytial virus, looking at influenza, and boosting our systems to track those diseases directly led by what are the priorities of the community and the public health department. So like you say, Kim, what data is available? I think there's this great interplay between what data is available and then also making sure that those of us who are trying to develop new things are really listening to what data is not available through traditional systems and what needs we can fill with these new approaches.
Thanks so much, Dr. Wolf. The next question actually touches on what all of you have already commented on a little bit. Here's the question. Health data is inherently personal and often very private. How do we build a sustainable sense of trust with patients and the public so they are willing to share not only information on reportable conditions, but also information about non-infectious diseases or other information that impacts health and wellness?
through interviewing and speaking to thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands of community members during COVID, doing active case investigation or contact tracing, really having that one-on-one contact and explaining this is what we're going to do with this. We acknowledge that we're asking you very sensitive personal questions. This information will be used to help prevent illness in our community has been very helpful, because you know, when you put an elected official up, they may just think they're talking points or something like that. But with that one-on-one contact, although it was a tremendous amount of work, really has changed sort of the view of transparency of what we're doing with our data in public health. And we've had a significantly different engagement with our interview teams and contact tracing teams after a few thousand rounds of interviewing.
Sounds like a lot of work.
Everybody's doing it though.
Yeah, that piece around trust, credibility, transparency, all of those things are interrelated. And I think perhaps, Kim, to add to what you're saying, the use of community partners, we've found at the foundation that, you know, we've had a substantial amount of partnership with community-based organizations that are located in the community, of the community, run by people from the community with lived experience, and they can serve as very effective partners in terms of interpreting and making sure that the public health department has its connections and is optimally using those connections and those relationships to be able to build on that trust and that understanding and the transparency needed to be able to share such personal information.
Yeah, from what Lauren is saying, I think that's a great point and a great description. And one of the things we're doing with wastewater monitoring in Atlanta actually is we have a project that is funded specifically to look at communication of wastewater results within various diverse communities in Atlanta, and to identify community stakeholders and do sort of a mapping exercise of who are the different people who need to be influencing both how we implement a program and how we communicate the results of that program within this community. And there was a great comment in the chat about, you know, we keep saying community, what do we mean by community? And how do we think about sort of all the intersectionality and how we define community? I think that one of the values that we have in the wastewater work is to be able to, first of all, not be collecting any identifiable information about people, right? We don't identify people at all. We can't. That's not how the process works. But we can say, you know, we're looking at this slice of the community, this area of the city, you know, that has certain characteristics that we want to be able to make sure that we understand, like, you know, how populations are accessing healthcare, you know, what sort of the socioeconomic diversity is in an area, and be able to break that up a little bit, and then even say, you know, we can look at individual institutions and monitor at different levels of the community to say that we can really make sure that we're serving people who are vulnerable, people whose information is reaching the high levels to identify the risk that they're at. And, you know, not just by linking a clinical case back to their address, but say, you know, where is that person actually in their community and where are they experiencing risk without identifying them? I think that's really powerful.
Thanks, Dr. Wolf. Okay, we have just about 3 minutes left. So we have one more question to discuss. So earlier we heard about the work of the National Commission to Transform Public Health Data Systems, and the commission report includes recommendations organized into three broad categories. Those are centering health equity and well-being in narrative change, prioritizing equitable governance and community engagement, and ensuring public health measurement captures and addresses structural racism and other inequities. So in considering why actionable intelligence matters, and from your experience, what is the significance of the first commission recommendation focused on narrative change?
All that in 3 minutes. Well, Kim and Marlene, I know you're gonna sort of jump in. I think that those three are intertwined, and part of the narrative change has to be some of the things that we've really started to wrestle with today, which is about explaining the context in history and the
the structural underpinnings of why we are finding what we do. So if we do the wastewater work and we find that a particular neighborhood has a high rate of exposure or shedding in this case of the virus, then that would need to be accompanied by an explanation of how did that neighborhood get to sort of be the experience that degree of risk, and have it not be framed in a way that sort of blames the individuals, like it's sort of your fault for living there, but what about it, what about the history of that place has collected all those sort of risks together in that structure. So I think that that requires a whole level of different way of speaking about it. And the last thing I would say on that point is to be sure that we're talking about the demographics and the intersectionalities of the communities, again, using the wastewater, to be clear that when we're talking about race as it's experienced and racism or the structural pieces that have created the boundaries for the challenges that have, such as segregation, that have sort of gotten people to be concentrated in particular areas, and to be really clear when we're describing that, what we're talking about. Because I think people are loose with those terms, and then people start to make false conclusions that, oh, it's like, well, these people are more susceptible to it because of their race, et cetera.
Thanks so much, Dr. Smith. Dr. Wolf or Dr. Rep, would you like to comment?
I think that was a really important nuance and to make sure we're clear in the way we're describing. And I think that the wastewater specifically looking at particular geographic areas, it allows us to get at some of those things, and it doesn't necessarily allow us to unpack all of that, right? But I think that so we have to be careful about what we can and what we cannot speak to, but I think the structural racism that exists in the way that our spaces are organized, is something that we can really focus on in using this data to illuminate that type of risk that exists because of that structure in ways that are not necessarily reflected in other data streams. That's true. It's true. It's there, whether we're able to describe it in the wastewater or other data. But I hope that we can use these strategies to help illuminate some of those structural issues that you so clearly described. And so that's my hope for it, and that data would be more and more publicly available so that communities can use that to advocate for themselves, right? To say, this is the risk that I'm experiencing in my community, and I want to make sure that my leaders know about that. And so I hope to see it used in that way even more going forward.
Thanks so much, Dr. Wolf.
Sorry, Dr. Pina.
Not at all. Please go ahead, Dr. Rep. I was just saying thanks.
Thank you, Lauren and Marlene. That was beautiful. I think data can always be weaponized if that is the intent of the person. And we know that is the intent of lots of people when they look at our data, especially at the population level and public health. We are starting to see the change of, we will not present data in any format without structuring it first in the social determinants of health, acknowledging the systemic and institutional racism that has led to this within our state and our county, period. So people can't get to the data without working through that paragraph first. And that's going to take a lot of time, but I think public health is absolutely responsible for framing every single piece of data we put out there in the social determinants of health to fix this narrative of victim blaming.
Well, I'd like to thank all three of our panelists today, Dr. Wolf, Dr. Smith, and Dr. Rep. Thank you so much for spending some time with us and talking about actionable intelligence. It's really an essential component of our response to health crises and pandemics. So hopefully we've given some food for thought to the rest of the audience. And I will now hand the microphone back to Dr. Monroe. Thanks, everyone.
Well, thank you so much, Dr. Pina and the panel. I mean, this was an amazing discussion, as all of the discussions today have been. So I want to thank everyone who joined us today, all of our speakers, our moderators, our panelists, and everyone, all of you that listened, tuned in to and so involved in the chat. I also want to thank our co-hosts, ASTO, NACHO, and Big Cities Health Coalition. Importantly, I also want to again thank our partners, United Health Foundation, the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation, and the Pew Charitable Trust for their support of the Lights, Camera, Action Summit series. We have a real challenge in front of us, and much of that has been discussed today, as we all collectively come together to set out the future of public health. We all know how difficult the last 2 years have been for our nation, for our world, and we know the sacrifices that have been made by our public health leaders and workers. While the challenges behind us and in front of us are very real, we also have an incredible opportunity to develop a new script for public health. And I believe conversations like we've had today are the way forward. I'm pleased that today's summit, along with the great and thoughtful work that has been developed by so many individuals and organizations, will help us in writing that new script and preparing our nation not only for the future health threats, but for the ongoing health-related issues of chronic, infectious, and environmental issues that we face. We will follow up with all of you who registered with summaries of the summits, and other materials will be coming out. We will be posting everything to our Lights, Camera, Action website, which is futureofpublichealth.org. We also hope that you will mark your calendars and join us for other topical summits in this national series. February 23rd, 2022, please join us for Effectively Financing Governmental Public Health Functions and Strengthening Public Health Law and Governance to Support a Modern System. I can promise that will be a robust session. And then in March, the date still to be announced will be catalyzing cross-sectoral partnerships and community engagement. And again, all of these summits you've heard, they are not distinctly by themselves, because you heard today about partnerships and community engagement as well, and some of the public health law issues that came up. So once the meeting ends, a brief feedback survey should pop up on your screen. Please take a couple of minutes to share your feedback with us. We are learning as we go, and we're improving as we go forward. So your feedback is vital to our improvement. You can also send us any other feedback to futureofpublichealth@iphionline.org. And if you've received an invitation for small breakout groups, please find your Zoom link to join us at 2:15 p.m. for further small discussion. And if you need any help, contact futureofph@iphionline.org. Thanks again to all of you, and wishing all of you a great afternoon.